when it comes to actually having a lot of different strategies available to them when it in pick and ban phase.
Jhin Air have desperately spent the whole of this summer season looking for a carry, and there's times when Chaser shines through from the jungle and can do that, specifically on that Nidalee pick that so frequently draws bans. It's just Chaser Nidalee excluded. The carries haven't been there. It's not Trace, certainly not the Rengar top aggressive player of 2 years ago. It hasn't been GBM, who is a very good role player. His Victor actually has taken over some games, but again, no reliability there. Pilot, he has a higher win percentage than Captain Jack, but they lose late game shot calling potential for that. So where's the carry coming through? That seems to always be the question when we watch the Jhin Air green wins.
Yes, it does. And it just in terms of their gold, they allocate it into weird places, jungle and AD carry. This is not really the meta to be doing that. You don't want to make those decisions if you are able. You want your gold to go into mid and top lane right now. That is where you have the most diversity in terms of picks, the most carrying potential at the moment.
That's why when we were talking about SK Telecom a couple of months ago, when we started to see Smeb, for example, playing the Riven top and these real true carries coming through, one of our question marks for SKT was, okay, in this top lane carry meta where mid and top are so focused, that's not Marin, he doesn't sound like the player, but so frequently, not just on the Rumble, but on the likes of Fizz, he's shown that new element to the game. He's shown that he can be a carry top laner. And that question mark has to go there for Trace, because that's just not one part of his game that he's shown. He's great at being denied. He's great at doing his best with limited resources. But that only goes so far, at least on patch 5.13.
Yeah. I really like this draft from Jhin Air, because they banned the Gragas second, which meant that Spenna was going to have to choose between Rek'Sai or TF to ban. And what they chose was to ban the TF. So that means first pick Rek'Sai. And if that didn't work, they would have given the Nidalee over to Chaser. So Ketch will be playing Nidalee. That is quite curious to me. Maokai taken away.
I mean, they take Maokai and Nidalee, which is a wonderful lane ganking combination. Of course, the targeted CC into very high burst damage. The Rek'Sai priority is a bit intriguing to me, because if you put lots of gold on Rek'Sai, or if he's dealing with limited, or she's dealing with limited resources, it's not really a champion that can carry from the jungle.
It's still a really strong pick
absolutely.
For Chaser.
It's still a very strong pick, but is it a pick that is symbolic with a winning game for Jhin Air, a winning comp for Jhin Air? Where are they going to find the damage? Because it's certainly not going to be the high damage Nidalee spears providing a lot of the team's damage from the jungle.
Well, in this particular draft, though, Jhin Air getting tons of comfort picks. Actually, Jhin Air has one of the highest percentages of having Rek'Sai banned against them of any team. And Alistar here, too. Comfort pick for Sweet. We see the Victor bans frequently against GBM, more often than the TF. People are more afraid of his Victor. He just gets it for free here in the second round of the draft on blue side. I don't really understand what the necessity of picking this Nidalee so early was when Sassen also plays the Victor. What is going to be his answer?
That's the question. Caitlyn being hovered over. We still haven't seen a Caitlyn in Champions, despite with those changes to the passive, specifically the armor penetration on the headshot. I feel like there's some interesting uses of the champion, specifically against someone like a Maokai who really stacks armor and gets super, super strong, but it seems like this is not going to be the game to show us something new. There's still the dream of the 5.13 item, AP item change. Velko is coming through that was flashed earlier, but even then, Maopilot insta-locks the Vayne.
Wow, so going for it this time.
Carry plants are on.
Yeah, and Pilot has been trending into playing more and more Vayne. This season in particular, that wasn't ever really a pick we saw him play before. And Rumble, just an easy lock-in here for Trace, that lowest of the low economy top laners.
And it's pretty much, you know, the comp that SKT was running the last two. Very similar. Lots of zones going to be created by the Equalizer, by Victor's W, just by all the CC and threat of the likes of Alistar and Rek'Sai. We'll see where Spenu goes with their mid lane pick. It's not going to be Imundo unless we're going to see Maokai middle and remember True 8 many years ago, the Triforce Rite of Ages, never forget.
They're going to flash over the Vel'Koz.
Dream.
Man, I love seeing Sassen play this Vel'Koz.
There's not a lot of backline threat. There are worse times to pick Vel'Koz.
Yeah, and he's been so good on it. He actually was outputting something like over 1,000 damage per minute in the game against SK Telecom, but Orianna, definitely a safer decision, but nowhere near as exciting.
Thinking about these, yeah, I don't know if this is quite the Orianna comp just because they've got Nidalee, they're looking for the Siege. Actually, it's going to be a rotational comp. They're going to take Lulu as the last pick just to match line wave clear with the Victor. Very low damage comp. And scarily, this is the sort of comp you'd expect from Jhin Air with, you know, their 19 KDA 3-0 Lulu player in GBM and their expert jungle Nidalee, because suddenly this comp, it's kind of about catch.
Yep. And it's also, speaking of catch, not only the player, but catching people out. This is a pick composition. You have to, it's a low damage 5v5 comp. SK Telecom, the first to really play around with Lulu and Sivir together back in the spring season. Now we've seen Jhin Air do it successfully too, but basically you have to all be on the same page and you create picks by getting to an objective first, waiting for Jhin Air to sort of file in one by one, and then immediately popping all your speed to collapse on one person. So it's an interesting pick comp in that you're not really playing with Fog of War, you're just playing based on sheer speed to get that Maokai in there on a Twisted Advance, follow up with a spear, and play with Burst. And so it's hard to do, though. It's hard to execute.
And for all Spenna's development, I wouldn't say they've ever really been all on the same page for an entire game. For parts of a game, sure. For early games, certainly. But the precision this comp requires, I think it's more than Spenu can really put together.
Yeah, if you get into a 5v5 late, Spenu is in trouble with this composition. Well, guys, can they pull it off? The pick comp? Let's see. Game one starts now.
Love the gusto of the Spenu fighting. Easily outplaying Jhin Air, at least before the match starts. So maybe there'll be some wind in the sails for what is execution heavy. And when you're 10th without a series win, execution heavy doesn't sound like it should be part of the vocabulary.
Yeah, that is. It is a risk. Now, to Spenu's credit, they've done okay with Juggernaut, which is another difficult to execute composition, but this plays, despite having a Lulu in the mid lane and an AD carry, this plays a lot differently to Juggernaut. You can't play Sivir in the same fashion. You can't just have her on the front line because she has that lower range and she will just get destroyed.
And just cast your minds back to that epic second game of KT versus Ku. Finally got to 40 minutes, finally got to the item times when Sumdae could just run away on that Kog'Maw, and if he didn't get shut down, could put out massive damage from range. That just could not be recreated with Sivir. It's all about the utility of the ultimate. Still a high damage threat, but you can't run through a team like Sivir with Sivir like you can with the Kog'Maw.
Yeah, it just doesn't work, especially if this Rek'Sai and this Alistar get particularly tanky on the other team, you probably won't have the percent damage to really deal with big front lines. So it's a risk, and it does mean that Spenu has to be on these dragons, and they're expecting Jhin Air to be a bit late or perhaps split up.
We talked a bit, or at least I talked a bit about Rek'Sai and the fact that, okay, harder to carry with. They're actually committing two members to this jungle follow here.
Wow, that is quite large. So no lane freeze, and they force Chaser's flash. So interesting, but this is going to allow Trace simply to walk into the top lane now.
Not going to have to deal with the same sort of freeze. I was going to say that Chaser, you know, I mentioned, okay, you get lots of gold onto Rek'Sai, you're not going to be able to do a true carry performance. Chaser's caught out, going to take more damage.
Yeah, Flame Spitter level 1, too.
But one thing Chaser can do to carry is to shut down catch. If Nidalee gets far behind, if he's in the jungle the whole time and denying buffs, which actually seems to be happening to Chaser this time out, this is actually a bit of a recreation of what KT was able to do. If Chaser's on top of catch, if Nidalee's not a factor, it'll be a great game for Jhin Air, but so far, very held down.
Well, they did get a ward onto the blue buff. So we did see Sweet walk up into the jungle to put that down. Now, are they going to dive 4v1? Trace is only level 2.
Okay, they have a couple of stacks of the wind to spy it. Goodbye, Trace.
Yep, goodbye. First blood for the Sivir, and ooh, barely gets out with the summoner heal and the flash. So risky, but they make it work, and they punish Trace for coming right back into that top side. They knew that that was a possibility, going from red to blue, so a bit sloppy there from Jhin Air.
That's Nidalee Sivir, so there's actually a lot of turret damage from level 2 onwards. Of course, on the Sivir, you can cancel your auto attack. They have a lot of turret damage. This could be the fastest outer turret falling in Champions this season.
Yeah, definitely. We never see these four-man stacks here. It's not like the LCS. So this is a bit of a rarity. And how are they just going to deny the wave as much as they possibly can? A nice luxury here from Spenu. So solid early game plan, actually. You can see it in action. They made a decision, going to not freeze the wave, let it push back towards the opponent, get the invade, and Trace pays for it. So first turret down in favor of Spenu.
We were talking about this stat with the owner of Oracle's Elixir, who was asking about these turret trays that we see in the very early game. I believe this is the first time we've seen one of those four-minute turrets. So how will that change the texture of the game? Because Trace, he's good at being denied, but it's much harder to be safe when you don't even have a turret to go back to.
Well, one of the reasons I feel that we don't see that strategy so often here in Korea is, first off, it took a couple of things going wrong for that to occur.
Sure.
Number one, they had to be starting Gromp right there in order to lose the buff. Trace had to overcommit to that tower kind of foolishly. And if you show your jungler in support like that, well, it really does put a lot of pressure on your mid lane. So there's a lot of, if you're willing to blow a lot of flashes and stuff, there's definitely the chance, a large one actually, to go ahead and kill the mid laner on the other team. So giving that information is not always the best way to move in League of Legends. And the other factor too is that when you commit like that, look at Pilot. He has now a large CS lead because he was just sitting there freezing and farming. And he's going to maintain that lead. You can see the wave is now bigger right here. So you're basically trading some global gold in exchange for concentrated gold on the enemy AD carry early. Because, of course, there have to be kind of four people there usually to deal with that turret. So you're not reliably going to be able to get isolated tower gold onto your AD.
At least we're getting information as to why they prioritized this Nidalee early. Because Nidalee, of course, had the big mobility to get onto that blue buff. I mean, this is definitely a pre-planned strategy by Spenu. They sent two members to stop that jungle follower. They sent their AD carry and just gave up any hopes of a freeze. Chased Chaser out of the top side jungle. They knew he was on the bottom side. So it was actually very well executed. But as you mentioned, it's not necessarily a winning strategy. It's a risky one. But given what they wanted to do, they pulled it off very well, especially for the 10th place side in the league.
Yeah, they did. But again, it comes into Trace's misplay. If they don't get the first blood gold there, we're only talking about a 500 gold lead, but yet there's still a nearly 20 CS difference on the Vayne. So if you want a really good example of this, go watch Cloud9 versus TDK, because TDK, being a team of about four Koreans, executes the Korean style of lane swap while Cloud9 tries to do the LCS style. And you can see how much gold gets onto Emperor's Draven in that game as a result of that move. And he just goes off. So that's the risk that you're playing around if the enemy team doesn't make a mistake like Trace did. So that's kind of the logic. I know that there haven't been a lot of people talking about this, but it's a good time to really dive into that considering this game.
We just haven't seen a lot of data points in champions, as you mentioned. So it took out the other turrets. That forces Rumble to play even safer, maybe even get zoned from experience. The other thing Spenu got was two very nice aggressive pink wards in the bottom side of the river. So they actually do have good dragon control. They have the 2v2. As you mentioned, there's a lot of gold on Pilot, but it's unspent gold at the moment. So theoretically, Spenu have a lot of dragon control. And speaking of dragon control, they have a jungler trying to really solidify this advantage.
Catches here, misses his spear. Sweet, just quickly sidesteps that. Chaser now moves into mid, wants to give GBM a little bit more freedom, and Trace sees the jungler, steps into the top side right now.
Trades are looking good for Saw, who's 15 CS ahead. Far Cry away from the Riven that does well in the matchup. Catch is actually caught himself. Nice little burst from Chaser, and removes some of that dragon threat.
Right, there's a nice condemn. Secret pops the Unbreakable, stops a little bit of that damage, and he slows up. Oh, Pilot going a bit nuts. Ooh! Dies. Sweet gets the Ignite kill. Nicely played by Jhin'Air. Bold. And that is a very important kill now down to the bottom side. I have to say, I'm a bit surprised that Saw didn't TP.
And Teleport available, of course, has a lot of counterplay with the targeted CC when he arrives. Chaser took a lot of free damage, so it doesn't look like Jhin'Air will be able to translate this into a dragon, but wonderful shopping opportunity for Pilot. He'll be sad he didn't pick up the kill, might have even been close to a completed Blade of the Ruined King with the extra 300 gold. But man, he's got a long way towards it.
Right. And the early pickup, too, of that pickaxe, one of the other factors, and we keep talking about this, but it's really interesting, is that when you take down that first turret and the other AD carry just stays in lane, sure, you get an earlier shot, but you're probably just going to be pushing out or getting pushed in. You're going to be maybe a little bit lower in levels, too, as a result. And so the AD carry on the other team is going to get a later shot. And when you just have that pickaxe, you're then trying to grind up to a BF sword. And now this is all Pilot from this point forward.
Yeah, the kill potential every time Pilot gets in range of just the Bilgewater now, but very soon to be the Blade of the Ruined King. It's always a very good 1v1 matchup for Vayne against the Sivir, but just going to be the reality. There's going to be a lot of pressure onto the Sivir. He's going to have to play just as defensively as Trace does in the top lane.
And with the Alistar about to hit 6, the dive potential is kind of going through the roof right now, as long as Rek'Sai wants to play down on the bottom side, which of course Chaser does.
CS lead is growing in top lane.
And here we go. Secret has no flash right now. He's going to bounce around, actually. Condemn doesn't hit. Catch there. There's the ultimate. It's coming through. And TPs from both top laners. Trace does not have his equalizer, actually. Had to use it previously. So actually, it gets turned around onto Sweet.
We didn't even notice that it was Sarsen running teleport as well for five members instantly into bottom lane. Obviously not worried about the solo kill potential from GBM. That might be important, not having a combat summoner when we're talking about the late game team fights. But they take the dragon, successful teleport from both the solos.
I was very surprised to see Sarsen doing that. So Jhin'Air actually with a bit of a disrespectful play, 2 TPs to just 1. And no equalizer, so kind of a lot of miscommunication right there from Jhin'Air. Yeah, I didn't notice that either, Papa.
And a super defensive first shot from Trace. Picks up the Merc strats. Now, against Ryze, this makes a lot of sense, but against Maokai, okay, it gives him decent combat stats. Okay, maybe that'll be a fast home guard and champ, but it's Rumble. It's not really the home guard champion. It's nice to have. It's more flexible. Maybe you'll get in a slightly better position for the equalizer. Equalizer's only going to be tickling, though, with no other true AP items.
And those 2 kills from Nuclear really going to be doing work now. He was able to go ahead and buy his BF sword with the help of that 2nd kill. So Jhin'Air not really following through, and Spenu actually getting a lot out of this lane swap thanks to Jhin'Air's mistakes. Just TP mistakes from Jhin'Air.
It's a luxury teleport for Sarsen, and usually there has to be a severe mismatch or just giving up on the laning phase for you to take a non-combat summoner in the mid lane, but you look down this enemy lineup, of course, there's going to be the Victor W, but Alistar's Headbutt Pulv and Rek'Sai's Unburrow aren't really, Cleanse is not really going to interact with those CC, so you do kind of have the luxury if you're not going to go for the Ignite for lane control.
Right, and that's typically what we see. Lulu does have a lot of safety with that Wild Growth and her shields and Whimsy, of course, so that's the typical answer, and he is going to be heading up into this top side. Trace going to overheat on a couple of rockets, but there's just no damage there with the Merc Treads.
Just no damage whatsoever. It's a lot of gold to spend for something that doesn't really feel like it's been necessitated by the picks that Spenno have put together.
Yeah, I wonder what his game is on that. Of course, he's going to be afraid, and all of the ganking damage coming through, whether it's Lulu or Nidalee or Maokai, is magic damage, but it's mostly just about that CC.
I mean, let's put it together. There's a lot of CC, because of course, we haven't even talked about Secret being able to apply the Winter's Bite and the Concussive Blows. The question is, when you don't have any items on the Rumble, when you're not a threat, where is your ideal positioning? Even if you have the Merc Treads, you're not going to be doing the damage or the tankiness to really impact a fight if you've got no oomph to your spells.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, to be fair, there's still good base damage for Rumble, but having a little bit of magic penetration can be very useful. Ketch comes through with the Scuttle Crab, and Ketch doing well. He's actually making plays in the early game this time.
So had a CS advantage, although after all the shenanigans, Trace, to his credit, has put together a couple CS advantage himself with the Spectre's Cowl double Doran.
Uh-oh. Chaser. And there he goes. Gets the Unburrow. Ketch has to run. Has that red buff. And try and turn this around right now. Chaser gets his Raptor buff procced, and they will clear out that ward in the river. They want to make a play on the blue buff,
or the bottom lane. Of course, Alistar, as you mentioned, hit level 7 now. Very easy to tank up this bottom lane turret. No teleport for Trace, or Saw for that matter, because they matched teleports just previously. So wait and see if any plays can be made around the bot lane. They really want to all in with Pilot, but they crucially don't quite have the play of the Rune King. I think he has the gold for it, just hasn't got the shot timing yet.
Yep, has to get back in order to pick up that big, big purchase for him. Nuclear wants the Berserker Greed, so he will have a delayed Infinity Edge here, as we typically see on the Sivir.
Curious that GBM has the Fiendish Codex in the inventory. Of course, we were mentioning that a lot of these Victor players don't want to pick up Merlin Omicron, or the Fiends for that matter, just because you have the less amount of item slots, you have the Hex Core to deal with, but guessing maybe went more defensive in the rune set. I guess it could be AP per level blues, but didn't go for the cooldown reduction. So one of those item slots, and what it basically means in the late game, you give up the likes of a Lich Bane or maybe just those really high 1,000-plus AP values.
Yeah, he usually actually really likes to buy the Lich Bane for the mobility. He's actually one of the players that almost always buys Lich Bane on Victor. So, but that does, of course, like you're saying, mean that there is less room for max AP there.
You just can't fit in Deathcap, Void Stuff, Zhonya's. That really fits into almost every AP build. So something has to give. And a utility purchase like Lich Bane, unfortunately, usually the first thing you have to give up.
Yep. Well, a little bit of a Raptor steal, and now Spenu, three-man invade onto their bottom side. GBM going to surprise Sasin a little bit, but he dodges the Death Ray with the Whimsy.
Swapping Raptor buffs. We just saw Chaser stealing Spenu's Raptors, and the receipt comes through from Spenu. So you can see where the points of power is so far. Jin, I feel comfortable playing in the top side jungle, even though Saw's way ahead of Trace in terms of effective items. Spenu have the control of the bottom side of the map, and when we're talking about 15 minutes, that's crucial because they have excellent ward coverage around Dragon, and they've already picked up the first one.
Yep. So just a little shy of a minute until the Dragon roars back onto the Rift. Pilot now completing his Blade of the Ruined King, so a nice item timing for the Vayne, but same could be said for Nuclear, as he puts the final touch on an Infinity Edge.
So he has Flash, he's staying out of vision. It'd be a bit crazy to go for any sort of Flash headbutt play with 30 seconds running down to the Dragon. Does require a bit of RNG, but man, Infinity Edge Berserker Greaves could be massive burst coming through from Nuclear.
Yeah, it could be. Now they know that Chaser is on the red buff right now. Drace kind of overextended in the top side, but he's the one at the moment who actually puts down pressure. Strangely has a blasting wand right now. That must have been just an awkward shopping timing.
It does build now into the Liandry's Taunt.
Yes, it does, I know, but you really would rather have that magic pen early.
But if you go for, say, the Merc Treads, you can't really build the Ruby Crystal towards a Haunted, guys. I think you have to go for the power, otherwise you're just mute. You just can't really contribute much. So the Blasting One's not the ideal first purchase. It does delay the Haunting Guys, like you mentioned, but at least it's a bit of AP to justify the Rumble pick.
Yeah, it's something. Sore, in the meanwhile, does not have the good engage tool yet of that Righteous Glory. Chaser coming here just to provide some safety while they move the minion wave closer to Spenu's turret. Catch landing a couple nice spears over the course of this time in the river. And they kind of drop pointlessly a ward right there that's immediately killed by the jungler from Spenu.
Dragon is live. This is just extending the laning phase, which is going just fine for Spenu, who do err towards power towards maybe the tail end of the mid game, specifically when the AP's really registering on both Catch and Sarsen. Managing to stop any threat of the Dragon, though, so I'm not sure what Spenu's game is right now.
Well, Jhin'Air will be happy just to sit on this Dragon as long as possible, get that Victor and the Vayne into a very scary late game state where that Maokai, as tanky as he is, will have a tough time against a Vayne.
Once the QSS comes, there's so many different ways to outplay if you're Pilot on the Vayne.
Ooh, a bit risky. Pilot training pretty well with Secret, did get that Condemn, but not substantial follow-up to really push on through here.
So Abyssal Scepter, actually the first pickup for Trace. Okay, that's a bit of immediate power. That buffs up GBM. Maybe we're talking about Sick Burst coming through from the Chaos Storm. But no Haunting Guys just yet.
We do see that occasionally under Rumble. I didn't expect it.
This is basically the build you see against Rocks. You see Merc Treads rush to deal with the stacking amount of CC coming through from the Rune Prison, then into Abyssal Scepter because it builds so nicely out of the Negatron Cloak. It's a very I'm feeling super threatened by AP damage kind of build. And again, there's a lot of AP damage on the side of Spenno. It's just curious to see it purchase so quickly in this particular matchup.
Yes, it is. Well, recall from Braum right now. Catch trying to make his way back down there. The crab has been taken by Chaser, so no one has a good angle on the dragon at the given time. Trace now making his way down the river. So it looks like they want to group up after they pushed it all the way to the tier one. Soar actually losing some farm due to that action. And now Jhin'Air is going to be five people on the bottom side of the map. And Soar has a long way to go to delay this if he wants to kind of push it all the way back to the tier two.
Doesn't have home guards, but does have that righteous glory. So which of these big purchases will be most impactful in this fight? That looms to be the big question. We're talking about Abyssal Scepter versus the Righteous Glory coming through from the Maokai. I feel like almost you need to teleport early because you had Ward Supremacy around this area and you're losing it thick and fast with the sweeping land.
Yeah, there you go. Pilot, they're waiting for him. He now gets onto the dragon. They're trying to burn it down. Catches there.
Defensive teleport coming through.
Yeah, but man, that's going to be an easy dragon. Sweet goes in onto Sasin, but I don't know how much follow-up is here at this point in time. Trace trying to kite this one out. Sweet just attempting to get out of a sticky situation. Flash onto the Glacial Fissure and just some more poke from the Jhin'Air Green Wings. They hold onto the Chaos Storm and the Equalizer.
Really curious defensive teleport from Soar. Just was never going to impact the fight. By the time he got within 1,000 units of the dragon, it was already down. They got good turret damage, but they held onto the Equalizer this long and just throw it down. And no answering turret being able to be picked up by Spenno.
Yeah, Jhin'Air did a good job of holding that. Sweet, perhaps looked like he was getting a little bit over-aggressive before we really saw Jhin'Air scale into where they needed to be, but he did get out with the flash, and that threat from Secret's Braum on the flank, just not enough. The Glacial Fissure not finding a target, and they knew that if Spenno over-pursued, if they tried to run down the river at them, that Chaos Storm and the Equalizer would absolutely wreck them.
This feels like the re-erring of some issues that Spenno had at the start of the season, specifically around teleport. Didn't feel like Soar knew when to teleport or where, and the result was a big-time summoner use for no gain whatsoever. We even say that swapping teleport for a single kill no objective is questionable by top laners, and that result, getting absolutely nothing, and Trace having that teleport advantage in what, Equalizer in 30 seconds? A lot of counterplay being open to Jhin'Air in the next 5 minutes.
Especially with how dominant Pilot is getting right here, although Nuclear has closed the CS gap a little bit. Trying to make a play, but Tumble will just allow Pilot to get out. Quick auto attack onto the turret. Jungler's now forced into this bottom side.
Catch has never been ganking this Maokai. He's never been playing around the targeted CC in lanes. A lot more conditional CC when we're talking about the likes of Braum and bot lane. Just been kind of throwing out spears as if it's an ARAM, and it's just not impacting the lanes whatsoever.
Yeah, that is, I mean, he's helping to clear these waves just a little bit, but doesn't really justify his presence or the fact that he is continually showing himself. They have a good ward there should Rumble want to TP.
Just what does throwing spears around bot lane when both dragon is down and your lane has no pressure really accomplish? And maybe it stops the dive from Pilot, but gives him time to go pick up the Rod of Ages. So Rod of Ages from the jungle has been the pickup by these Nidalee. It's going to be 32 minutes, though, very late in the game before that 10 stack comes through.
Yeah, it's, I mean, it's about a normal timing from a jungle Nidalee.
Feels like a couple of minutes.
Yeah, a couple minutes late. Usually it's 20, 21 minutes. And like you said, those stacks not going to be showing up or making a really big impact for some time in this game. Meanwhile, Chaser will have the option to finish that Aegis of the Legion to cut down on some of Spenno's magic damage. And all props to Trace this game. He's managed to get back into it, keep even in terms of farm. But, I mean, really, catch, power up that Maokai right now. Go for those easy kills in the long lane.
Just think about how much power Soar had, you know, with the Spectre's Cowl double Dorans against just a Merc Treads Rumble. And they didn't play around the lane to the extent that Rumble found all the extra CS, was able to farm back up. All the pressure from Catch was bottom lane, despite not having the CC in the lane. No realistic chance to pull up a gank. Okay, now finally just showing in the lane and pushing. This is something he could have done 8 minutes ago.
And Chaser does have a tunnel right there if he wants to Void Rush, so there's not realistically so much pressure. They could match TP from the mid lane, but they likely lose the tower.
You need to make the percentage plays with the jungle Nilly, who can definitely snowball out of control. And look, it hasn't been an objectively poor game for Catch, who's struggled a lot of this season. It's just the smart junglers, the likes of Chaser, they know where to be on the map to impact his Nidalee, whether we're talking about kill pressure or putting down towers in the bottom lane.
And here we go. There's the teleport coming through. Preyseeker already on the backside. Nuclear is going to get low, but he's not going to die, except when the equalizer comes in. Chaser locked up underneath the turret, but Secret is falling too as the chair collapses on him, sadly.
And Maokai's still not there, doesn't have teleport. We talked about what they paid for not getting any impact onto the previous dragon fight. Okay, teleport's going to be up for dragon, but Trace, two kill involvements, and it should be the outer turret coming down for Jhinnah.
Yeah, immediate Haunting Guys purchase, so now he's got the tools he needs, just a boatload of magic penetration to power up his abilities. And that's actually very good against champions like Nidalee, because Nidalee is so squishy at this point in time.
I see the rebate. This is the standard all-in from Blade the Ruined King Vayne, but it's the other member, specifically Chaser's in position. It was a heroic flash heal from Catch, very much on point, but the equalizer made it all move.
Yeah, that equalizer was perfectly placed too when they saw that that kill was not going to be coming through from Chaser. So now Jhinnah snags the gold lead. They've been a little bit behind this game, but now they get it. And some nice kills and assists onto the likes of Pilot and Trace. So everything going their way. Sossen used teleport, but wasn't able to have much of an effect with it.
These teams and champions have sent a lot of jungle Nidalee, a lot of junglers, specifically Chaser. I've been loving to pick it up. You mentioned on the cast yesterday, big issue for these jungle Nidalee teams is who picks up the Aegis. And it's probably going to be Maokai maybe later in the game, or no one at all. Now, the one thing that I've noticed that teams have been smart to pick up, and Jhinnah here as well, if there's no Aegis on the enemy team and the tankiness in general with the likes of a Nidalee is lower, you can afford to go items like QSS third, because you're not pressured to put out the same damage, because it's just not the same resistance, especially from the jungle on Nidalee.
It also makes the flat magic pen that Trace has
so effective,
so much more valuable. Especially when you have a Victor with that huge burst. I mean, Trace is just going to help out GBM too.
The damage is going to stick on everyone except Maokai, so the base damage is there. He's going to draw the teleport, but it's quite late again.
Way too late. Terrible positioning. There we go. Flash pull. And guess who's in the front line? It will be Secret. And he is the first to fall here. Soar has to flash. But there is a tunnel on Burrow. Soar just locked up. Tries to turn around with the Twisted Advance. Now gets Wild Growth. That's not who you want a Wild Growth. And there we go. Another kill for Jhinnah. They can just turn on to Baron maybe after they push this up.
Hope comes through. The wave clear on Sivir is good, but this is lost minimization for a Spender team who is really looking to snowball after the first dragon.
And you simply cannot play this composition like Spender has. The entire point is Maokai is there first. You pop this, you pop Whimsy on him, you pop the Sivir ult, and you collapse around one side of the pit. This strategy is actually super good on red side because you have at the dragon longer routes to get around into the river. So it's a great red side strat in particular because it's harder for the other team to kind of all filter in from the mid and the bottom lanes into that objective. So it buys you more time to get that pick. But Spenu, with Maokai there, after the dragon starts, late into the fight, before Jhinnah groups up, this composition will never work like that unless your opponent massively misplays.
Talked about the ironic use of terms like the Spenu teleport earlier in the season. To their credit, both Saw and Soul have improved at that as the season has gone on, but those old issues are really cropping up again. Two fights in a row around dragon where Soul's been present, you know, the teleport's been completed after the objective has gone down. Maokai really can't do anything. Spenu took that early outer turret, got smart wards around the dragon. That's where it ended for them in terms of smart play around this comp, specifically Catch just throwing spears and just not impacting powerful lanes, rather just really trying to relieve pressure when he just could have compounded on Trace's misery in top lane.
Yeah, that, I mean, Trace has been playing it pretty far forward, but because Catch, even when he's invisible, they keep seeing spears. He knows he can always push forward. He knows where Catch is on the map. And that has led to a high degree of freedom in a lane that they could have really targeted and shut down, like you're saying.
It's crazy that Trace has been safer post his turret going down, having no items at, what, 2-5 minutes into the game. than any had any right to be. This is a guy who thrives on being denied, who thrives on playing safely. Don't have to play safe when it's predictable exactly where the positioning of the enemy jungler is without even having to have any wards.
Yeah, well, Sweet is going to take some damage thanks to a Diddly Spear hitting the Baron. But Jhin Air, they have that center of the map presence. They have that first mid lane turret down, so they're going to easily be able to continuously threaten Baron from this point forward. Tower goes down to a split push from the Lulu, but a bit risky. They can collapse on Sossin right here. Chaser already moving to cut her off, but she's going to get away with the whimsy. Sees Chaser on that pink ward.
Isolated mid lane means that Victor's free farm now has the death cap on top of the cooldown reduction. Massive burst, especially when in Abyssal Scepter range from Trace. This is what was allowed by all the movements, specifically Nidalee being on the bot side, was a free farm mid lane, and Victor can really punish a no Aegis lineup that we once again have to know.
Yep, and TP advantage to Jhin Air once again. Of course, Sossin has it, so that's why he's in the bottom side trying to deal with this Rumble. However, still a lot of magic resist there, courtesy of the Abyssal Scepter, so Trace will be able to handle that pretty darn well.
Yeah, at this point, the game very likely to play out kind of as we expected, but it was nice to see Spenu try something, you know, very early into the game. It actually, for me, is reminiscent of Energy Pacemaker, the bottom face team from the LPL spring season, who had innovative strategies like getting those 2-, 3-, 4-minute dragons, but it's all about what you turn that into. What do you parlay the advantage you got at 4 minutes into 10, 15 minutes down the line? And sadly, the answer for Spenu was nothing.
Yeah.
A disadvantage, even.
Well, it was a temporary advantage. They had that nice, they got Sivir rolling in a way that was kind of unusual thanks to mistakes from Jhin Air. But beyond that, it hasn't resulted in a whole hell of a lot. So we now have the Rumble just continuing to split push right now. Maokai will have his TP back up soon. Chaser and Sweet trying to set up picks around the backside of Spenu's red buff. GBM is there in the shadows waiting. And oh, flash pull of Catch gets caught, but headbutted out the wrong way. Had to flash himself. Trace commits with his TP, actually. So now they kind of have to do something when Maokai it comes to this Baron.
And Maokai has his teleport up. Okay, Baron control excellently in Jhin Air's purview. They got the pink wards on it, multiple pink wards around the area. Maokai can come in at any point, but those teleports have certainly been off. And in a double teleport game, I guess we once again forget, Sossin has the teleport as well. Sossin's teleports contributed precisely nothing apart from getting Sivir snowballing very early into the game, and Saw's been really off the boil with his use personally.
Well, at the time though, now that they have the two TPs up, at least they can 1-3-1, but no one has really enough to deal with Vayne. We see Sore actually finishing his Spirit Visage before getting any kind of armor, and this is going to allow Pilot just to build straight into an Infinity Edge before he gets a Last Whisper.
And if you're going to commit to a item that builds out a Kindle Gem that gives you magic resist, Locket's right there, and it's something the team desperately needs. I don't really see what the extra selfish stats from the Spirit Visage, the extra heal, really accomplishes for the Spenu lineup. So, not liking that purchase either.
Well, he gets healed more from Italy now, too.
Pray.
So, Dragon back up. Dragon has the position from Jhin Air already. Sossin around the side. They're pinging him out, though. Now, they're going to go for a little bit of a 50-50. Vayne going to get it. Now, there's the immediate engage. Huge equalizer onto the back line. And there is really not a whole lot that they're going to be able to do. Sore gets locked up in a gravity field, but there's just too much persistent damage. And this is Spenu having to back off. Chaser comes back in. They are on the run right now, but there's the Chaos Storm. Trace passes forward, but he gets a flash out of Sivir too. And Jhin Air's Pilot grabs the kill onto the Maokai. 3-for-none for Jhin Air, and there is the Baron that they were looking for. A little bit of life stealing off of the wards as they make their way down the river.
Vayne going to do, obviously, immense Baron damage. Lulu's alive. Nuclear's not that low, but isn't actually rotating to Baron, which is just a mistake. Saw will be able to teleport in 20 seconds. I mean, Sossin could even go back and teleport themselves, but Sweep was used and Baron started.
And there it goes quite quickly with the Vayne just giving all those auto attacks and the two silver procs. And Sossin does what he can. pops his wild growth to help tank a turret, and then he will come out and kill some of these tunnels. Take a look at that fight again.
So Pilot is actually zoned out of doing damage for a lot of this fight. Uses the Blade Room, he gets a couple of auto attacks in, but it's doing basically nothing at this point. But Nuclear is kind of the same story, and is the only true damage threat on the team. The moment Nuclear gets chunked out, you can see the re-engage confidently coming through from Jenna. They hold on to the gravity field so late, and then just pile on the kills.
They are very smart, though, for holding on to the Chaos Storm and the Equalizer in some of these fights. They know that if the re-engage comes, they will instantly win as long as they have that ability. Pilot got some decent damage there down at the end, even if he didn't have a whole lot up front.
GBM does pick up the Lich Bane regardless of the item slot issue.
He always
does. Only going to be the Death Cap, it's only going to be the Void stuff. Against, I guess you could argue that against a team that at this point really can't put together an Aegis, there's not really any rush to finish the Void stuff.
That's true. There isn't that much of an incentive in this particular game, except to help kill that Maokai just a little bit faster.
Veins all over that one, Monte Cristo.
Yeah, precisely. Well, I'm a bit curious about this because Ketch just hasn't been there with the Nidalee yet.
Infinity Edge.
Yeah, already done here.
To feel secure enough to build an Infinity Edge over a Bloodthirster, over a Last Whisper, there's really no armor to speak about or resist in general on Spanner's side. That is crazy free hit damage coming through from Pilot.
Or Peel, honestly. It's not like there's a big tank line for Jhin'Air.
It's true.
But, yeah, as... I mean, when it comes to Jhin'Air at this stage of the game, sure, they're only 4K ahead, but they are absolutely owning the tempo.
Tempo is what a comp with Lulu and Sivir, this Jugga Sivir-esque comp requires, is to play from ahead, is to have control over objectives, Baron, dragons, turrets. They don't have the advantage in any of those. To their credit, even in turrets, but no advantage to speak of. A sweet pops the Righteous Glory.
He's going in, flash onto the back line, and there's the follow-up Equalizer. You see Spendo just getting out of the turret range right now, falling right back to their inhibitor. Meanwhile, Chaser was putting on a split push right here with a nice big minion wave. He's actually just going to get it. Saucin, gets the whimsy, so maybe get a kill, but no. There is the rest of Jhin'Air showing up at the last second to help out Chaser. They don't quite get the tier two in the mid lane, but that's going to be enough. They force Spenu back into their base in the bottom side and can do the same right here. Chaos Storm still up. One more turret for Jhin'Air.
Rek'Sai could have gone. Someone needs to go, though, to deal with this top lane minion wave push that's come through from Spenu. So Jhin'Air finally backs away. They'll hold on to their own buff, so that's something. Although Chaser, not quite done yet, gets a ward down. But it looks like it's still going to be Spenu's red buff.
Now he's just here to keep the pressure on while the rest of his team goes back for a nice little shopping trip. Chaser actually gets the red buff with a Prey Seeker.
That was very casual. Very casual. It's just been a casual performance from Jhin'Air. They would have been surprised by Spenu just exploding off the blocks with something different that we don't see in Champions, as you mentioned. A bit more common, like so the NALCS in particular, but it's just turning, you know, just doing something different. Committing two people to stop the jungle follow, taking that early out of turret. That was the start of maybe a match-winning strategy from Spenu. It's just, they seem to drop the strategy book somewhere in the rotation down to bottom lane.
Yeah, I just am not even... I don't even really consider that the best way to do lane swaps right now for the reasons I stated. I feel it gives so much information to the other team because you know 100% where their entire team is right then, and you kind of take your foot off the gas in terms of kill pressure while the enemy AD carry gets an advantage. So,
and while I agree with that as a general strategy, the bigger point though, Monty, is that you see that a lot in other scenes. It becomes a regular thing, something you can play around. When it's the first time we've seen it in Champions, it can be a great one-off strategy. It was something different. It caught us both off by surprise. It's just, even in this particular case, they couldn't put it together to more and more.
I totally agree, and it caught Trace by surprise too, because he just kind of went into autopilot right there and made the wrong decision in that situation. Wasting his teleport and giving up first blood to a pretty easy dive.
Spenu just poke around in these open waves. Not a lot of engage coming through from Jhin'Air, so they're relatively free to just sit in these lanes, but when they start to come to the chokes.
Oh, and there you go. Condemned lands, and the TP not going to do much. Soar is there, but he's just a target for Vayne. Has to get onto Chaser, but Chaser, a tanky target that's not going to do much when he Twisted advances onto it. Sweeps still walking forward, even though he's a cat, misses his Pulverize. And here comes GBM. They split up a little bit, catch on the run, and this Lulu and this Nidalee going to be a bit too fast for them to handle. Dragon is live. They could go for number four, but they want the inhibitor instead with two members down.
There's only Sivir for Wavedon, and Sivir was harangued out towards the red buff. Has backed now, so we'll be there to try and stop. But with multiple members, this should be the inhibitor for Jhinnair.
Yep. Easy play. They're all at full HP now, too, after Chaser used the Void Rush to get back into the mix, and they can quite simply fall back onto the dragon, take number four.
What Sassen's doing, he just makes the most of a bad situation. He did it with the outer mid turret. Now he's doing it with the inner turret, takes it down despite having no mana whatsoever. Realistically, they weren't going to be strong enough or in position to contest for this dragon, specifically with Saw's TP down. So he gets something, but it's probably just going to be an asterisk on a win for Jhinnair Greenwings.
Yeah, and it couldn't be lining up more perfectly in terms of timers. Look at this Baron. They are able to have time, push out their wave in the top lane. Very methodical approach to the Baron right here. As they take the dragon, they should be there right as it spawns to grab it.
It's been solid, smart play by Jhinnair, despite being surprised, as we mentioned, but a lot of that facilitated by a Spenu side that just seemed to lose track of what they wanted to do about 10 minutes in. It's just been kind of academic for the last 30.
Well, Pilot and Sweet have actually been having a pretty good game. They both have 100% kill contribution so far in this one, and it's like Jhinnair finally moving on to that Baron, but they've been pretty essential in all of the skirmishes, all of the team fights, and they've been able to deliver. So here we go, Jhinnair immediately on their Trace. Do they see him? They do. They pinged him right there. Are they going to go in all in anyway? There's another flash, and Sweet gets in. So there's an equalizer splitting up the carries from the back line. Sassen has to run. Secret so low, but Pilot just tumbling forward so easily to get the kills.
No threat whatsoever on Pilot with the Infinity Edge just blowing down members. They have a lot of quick members. You know, Spinner can pop the whims, they can pop the ultimate from Sivir, they're on the hunt and get away so they can actually get out of Pilot's auto attack range, but they're only going one way towards their base with only a few members left. Saw getting burned down, more appropriate Rumble versus Maokai action happening off screen.
Well, he couldn't prevent any forest fires this game. No Pokey the Bear would be quite sad.
Speaking of sad, Sassen's dead. So are Spenu's hopes, and Jhinnair, they're going to win the game.
That's right. Ace will lead to a Jhinnair victory, 15-2 when it comes to kills. Trace will show up for the Nexus Explosion Party with his teleport at the tail end. So Jhinnair bounced back from a mistake in the lane swap. They got caught out by the old LCS lane swap right there and made some not-so-great decisions surrounding it, but in the end, we see Sweet and Pilot doing work. Sweet missed out on a kill at the end of the game, sadly enough, so it doesn't end the game with the 100% kill contribution, but still a solid performance.
Just a solid performance from Jhinnair in general. Spenu, it was nice to see them try something. Would have preferred this earlier in the season where they could try and take information from the little advantages they're able to get and try and put together or cobble together a winning game plan. But
particularly since it's not a champion that we're used to seeing catch play, well, we will see if that changes up here in Pick and Ban in Game 2. Again, the Twisted Fate ban.
On blue side, no less. Now, Twisted Fate doesn't really...
I mean, Twisted Fate is a red side champion,
sure.
He's a red side fifth pick. I mean, we're not at the stage where it's first pick, first ban. That's not to say we won't get there as the patches keep rolling, as the backline threat keeps diminishing. There is always the potential for Twisted Fate to take over a meta again. And some might argue that's already here, but so far in Champion, it's been a bit sparing with the TF.
Yeah, it's not quite here yet, I feel. I mean, if we start seeing things like Maokai nerfs, then we may be in Twisted Fate land. But
Twisted Fate's in the air. I don't know what that means. I don't know what it smells like or looks like. It's probably some cards being thrown out. But for now, still, a lot of respect to GBM, who, again, it's just so damn annoying keeping tabs on both the teleport and the Destiny cooldowns.
It is. Well, Vane and Ezreal, the final two bands, they are going to take Alistar for Secret. That has been his best champion. The Ezreal, I'm a bit surprised to see. GBM has been an Ezreal player in the past, even though we haven't seen Jhin Air really emphasize that Runeglaive. They're just going to take Victor right here.
Long time since we've seen Alistar first pick. He's definitely fallen through picks and ban priority. The likes of Cogmore, the likes of Braum have been taken at a higher priority. So I don't think Jhin Air's worried about giving away the Alistar. Chaser, thinking about doing his best Tom impression. No. Any noted Udyr player.
Simple. Just take the Kog'Maw, take the
Simple,
Victor.
Like Skarner. It's got the point and click ultimate. It's great. Simple.
Simple. Like trolling Cloud Templar, like they always do.
Devourous Skarner. It's all right. Okay, the Amumu now, we're just getting into pure troll territory.
Well, it's just trolling Cloud Templar. That's how you do things. It's been this way for years, Papa Smithy.
Team Dark, they had it the best.
They had it the best. Well, I assume it's going to be a Victor here. Why take anything else? And there you go. Kog'Maw and Victor, the pickups. They don't have to grab the Braum early as they have some flexibility. So Sweet's just going to give GBM a nice shoulder massage during picks and bans. GBM delivers on that Victor pick. That's why people ban it. So Rumble could be the pickup here. But I have a feeling Jhin Air, see if I can predict the rest of their ban fades. Okay.
Oh, I'm listening.
Well, it's going to be obviously Rumble or Maokai. Uh-huh. Yeah, pick that one. They need a probably Maokai if Spedu doesn't pick it up because they need a little bit more engage because they'd like to pick the Braum.
It's nice to deny away from counterplay against the Kog'Maw in the backline as well.
Yeah, exactly. So Spedu should take the Maokai here, but if they don't, I think we'll see Maokai, Braum, and they'll hold their jungle until the final pick and then lock in Nidalee if they can.
Nidalee banned.
Oh, damn, they're going to get Gragas then. Which always has some nice synergy there with Victor and Kog'Maw.
It feels like I've already seen that game, maybe multiple times today, but it feels like I know exactly how that'll pick out. But look, they're throwing out the playbook. They might even lock in the Gragas early, Monte Cristo.
Oh boy.
Hold that support to last.
That's right. The question is it Braum or is it Annie? I'm going to wait and see what the mid laner is before coming to that conclusion.
Need to see some threats to work out what's really necessary.
But Braum is just so much better with Kog'Maw than Annie is. You get that peel and you get those long range stuns that you can proc with the concussive blows.
Waiting to see a mid laner. We're hoping to send him this from Sarsen.
Oh, please don't do this again.
Oh, they might do it again.
Now, to be fair,
more reliable comp this time.
Not,
it's not jungle Nidalee, at least they've got the Rek'Sai. It's much more targeted. This
that's
is basically
true.
The let's control dragon and hopefully get five of them come.
That's very true. And Sol has been more reliable in terms of teleports. So they've got that working for them. If they try the Sivir Lulu combination, it will be Corki and Jarvan. Okay, well, now we've got something interesting to talk about. Spenu, definitely the most Jarvan-y team.
Jarvan middle lane, no.
Yes, it is, of course. That is not something that is played often here. Of course, Keen is in NALCS, so that's where that usually goes down. But they want to all in the Victor early. Okie dokie.
This is really exciting. We've seen Gamsu obviously do a lot of top Jarvan in the LCS. It's also been played in the LPL. It's a kill lane in the mid lane, but...
I did it, Papa Smithy.
Did
I predicted
you?
Their composition.
You absolutely did. Now they look at it. Not in the right order, so you're going to lose a couple of the bonus points from that.
At least I get a B+. Can I have a B+?
You can have an A-.
Oh, you're so gracious.
You can think about what could have been.
I think that's some great inflation, though, Papa Smithy. I think you're being a little too easy on me.
I'm just marking you by the American system. So A- for you. If this was Britain, that'd be a C, I believe. But you guys get points for effort.
It is, actually. Really sad, the state of great inflation in America. You know, I had one professor in college who did not subscribe to that whatsoever. It was hilarious to watch people's GPAs tank in her classes. Well, we are going to get into game two on the night. Spenu, they've got the Jarvan Rumble hot pot combination. They are all in the mid game. If this goes late, they will do nothing and they will die. Jarvan will just die instantly to Victor Burst. So a bit curious, we'll see how Chaser and Catch play around this mid lane. If GBM can turn it early and get a kill, could be a disaster for Spenu, but I like the aggression.
Maokai, Gragas, Brom, all expected to be rotating around that mid lane, just trying to provide a little bit of defensive utility. GBM's gone for the most defensive option of all with the summoner spell. He's going with the barrier just to block as much damage as possible.
Well, let's get into game two, guys. Jhinnair, Spenu. Sassen dives into his champion pool again and pulls out mid lane Jarvan. So Chaser here talking up a storm in the early game. It would appear as a little bit of a weird invade going to be coming in from Jhinnair. They want to make a play in the top side of the map. Now it would be great for them to get a lane swap here, freeing up the Braum and the tree. Maokai, there we go, on the map for some early mid lane pressure and to make Sassen maybe think twice about chunking out GBM.
Surprisingly defensive opening items for Sassen. He's gone for the flask. You could have just gone for longsword, three potions. The mana sustain, look, it does help you poke a little bit more with your Q from range, but surprisingly not all-in item choice for what is an all-in champion through and through.
Well, that the problem with doing that, though, is Jarvan's mana costs are not great early on in the game. And if you don't have any sustain, you have to choose, do you want to hit harder or more often, I feel.
That is a trade-off.
It is a trade-off.
Now, you're a man that's skilled in the fighting arts. Which is the smarter?
More often, I would say, in this particular situation, of course. I think you just want to keep on training, but no sapling invade. Jhinnair's actual level one would have pushed back anyone to who is trying to go for a sapling invade right here. So this is a smart idea with a Maokai, actually, if you actually want to give a level advantage over. And that's going to be a high premium in this game because they need to give GBM every advantage he can get. And he's actually starting Q.
Yeah, it's against a melee champion, so Q starts not a really big issue. Could even go for a couple of points in Q, but
GBM with the manner laughing after dodging the first dragon lance
you
right
saw
there.
The
I
skulls.
Love it.
You saw the skulls. This is where he's at. This is demon GBM today.
And he's dancing now. And he's trying to distract him because guess who's coming in from behind? It is Sweet on the Braum. The lane swap that we talked about is successful for Jhinnair. Well, this is cute already. I love it, Papa Smithy. I love it.
We're playing musical chairs around mid. Maokai is going to be there. The Braum's going to come visit. Everyone is going to do their best to keep GBM topped up in this mid lane.
Indeed, they will. Well, GBM's falling back for the moment. He's got nothing really to worry about right now. He can just sit there right next to his turret. No kill pressure on him, and a bit of a challenge for Sassen to be trading with him early.
Just to see the skills, might see an extra point into Q. I don't think it's really necessary. I think the instant wave clear will be more important as another dodge comes through. He's got the mana sustain, so not as critical that he registers every bit of poke.
Right, but he's missing a lot of them. GBM seems very comfortable playing against this Jarvan.
This is definitely a champion that picks up one AD item, the likes of Tiamat, and can just go crazy. In fact, when we see these top lane Jarvans, you might think, okay, Tiamat into tanky. No, no, no. Infinity Edge often comes out just for the instant kill. If you're trading your Jarvan, whether it's top or mid, for either Kog'Maw or Victor, specifically in a burst capacity, job done for the Jarvan.
Yeah, and you have so much mid-game power and cleanup with the Rumble and the Corki. I'm curious whether Jhinnair is going to commit to any kind of early dragons at all, because they certainly don't have to.
If you get pink wards around the dragon, you cannot face check a Jarvan. You will die instantly.
Yes, yes you will. Well, Sol getting zoned off the wave right now. Maokai now making his way down into the bottom lane. Sweet sticking around top for the most part, so no one actually making a play on the mid lane, despite how extended Jarvan is. GBM just playing it nice and safe. He wants his farm, and this is how GBM plays. Stand next to his tier one, be very consistent and reliable. One of the most defensive mid laners in this league. And here we go, Chaser coming through for a gank, and that's gonna be a flash immediately. And there's a flash double knockup, actually. Secret getting a bit low. They're not going to be able to commit. So flash for a flash right there. Maybe not worth it for that flash from Chaser.
Let's come back to your previous point. JBM, excellent defensive lane of Trace as well. And there's a reason that you don't want to necessarily pick a lot of these super all-in picks like Sarsen, is that JBM will do fine. It's just, again, comes back to the core identity of where does the carry come from. If you've got a mid lane that's so happy to be denied, that's kind of the issue that's plagued them against the top teams. In this particular situation, though, with Pilot on form especially, remember, he's been switching places with Captain Jack most of the season. If Pilot can be the carry for this team, and you play into their positions of advantage, then I think Jhin will be just fine.
Yeah.
Farm.
Yeah, that's right. You need to punish GBM for his decision-making, and that's what we see teams do a lot of the time, is that they start to actually just press forward in the lane, and then they invade Chaser. Because there's a blueprint to beating Jhin Air, because, like you're saying, the solo laners are defensive in nature. That means they can't react as quickly in the jungle if they're under their tier 1 turret as your solo laners. So go in there and try and mess with Chaser, because if you shut Chaser down, you shut Jhin Air down, and there's just not that same ability for them to be resistant to heavy invading.
And the people listening might think, okay, but if you're under your own turret, you know, playing defensively, being denied, you have the shorter route to helping with the invade. But the big issue is you can't leave those massive clumped up minion waves that Trace and GBM are often waiting to crash into the turret. The opportunity cost of defending is so high. That's why invades will work, and that's what teams have been taking advantage of.
It's also because to get to your own jungle at that stage, you have to walk through some narrow chokes, and you're almost certainly going to take a bad trade out of the mid lane. I mean, if we look at where GBM was just walking through right there, Jarvan has every opportunity to land a combo, and it's much harder for Victor to do the same when you have the freedom of the entire lane in the river. So it's basically they know exactly what your decision is going to be, that you have many more choices to make if you have the freedom to leave and are in the larger space.
You just compare Jhin Air to a team like SKT, which push multiple waves. Sometimes Marin dies, sometimes Faker dies in the early game, but they keep applying pressure and always have the option to invade the enemy jungle, whereas Jhin Air always playing defensively. Enemy jungler mid lane, or even the support are on the same wavelength and invading, like the likes of Peekaboo and Score. You're given that freedom to get both the vision and contest the buffs that other teams just won't give you.
Yes. Well, let's take a look at what's going on in the mid lane right now. They're going to try for it all in, but GBM, Sasan going to take a turret shot. There's the gravity field. Catch was trying to follow up. Chaser already there. There's a knockup. Can they turn this around? Sasan really doesn't have any more damage. He got his Hex Drinker, but that is a major failure right there. He didn't get any damage from his combo. He used it to close the gap to use his ult, so that was pretty bad.
That was awful.
That was real bad.
That's some putrid mid-Jarvan play coming through from Sarsen. We commend his Vel'Koz. That's right at the side of the meta, but the Jarvan...
I thought Sarsen would be able to pull this off because he's shown such a large champion pool and been at least proficient on a lot of champions, but if we look at his Jarvan skill shots, and then that...
What is an EQ into R with, what, Rek'Sai pressure exactly supposed to? There's no damage coming from the Rek'Sai.
I mean, maybe if Rek'Sai was Warrior Enchant here, which frankly is probably a better build for Rek'Sai in this game. You're already all-inning on the mid-game. You might as well just double down.
Man, so definitely sub-challenger mid-lane Jarvan play coming from Sarsen.
It's pretty bad. Well, he's farming well.
To that inevitable late-game power of Jarvan. We're going to fall off in terms of reliability, so... Look, Spinner want to make something happen early. That's what we commend them for, but maybe not the Jarvan.
Okay, well, they want to go for this. Kog'Maw's still in top, so they're actually going to deny the blue buff. That's a good takeaway from the victor, at the very least. Catch ends up with it in the end, and it seems like they'll be able to easily take their own blue as well. So GBM going to have to deal with that. So they got something. It's not as bad as it could be.
Second point into the W. Usually the EQ, just the sheer extra 50, 60 damage, which might be the difference between the all-in and just falling down. Surprising to see him go for the defensive option. The Hex Drinker, again, on the defensive side. But because it's Victor who does so much damage, specifically in his fairly short range of control, I don't mind the Hex Drinker start. I just think you need to put the power and damage everywhere else.
Well, I guess I'm a bit surprised because GBM is not building anything resembling armor right now. Of course, getting that early arm guard is pretty terrible on Victor, but you'd think that you may want to side with just a little bit of caution. But can you really blame him with the way that he sees Sasid playing? Are you actually scared of dying right here?
Well, I mean, you've got the second hex core upgrade as well, which gives you the movement speed. You're already dodging the skill shots. Now, the worry here is that he's too clever, too fast, and will juke into the bad skill shots. So maybe he's handicapped himself that way, but otherwise, you know, when someone EQRs you and misses the combo on mid lane Jarvan, armor can wait a little bit.
Yeah. Sasin grabs the blue, though. That'll be huge for further harassment.
Will it?
Well, we're going to find out, won't we? GBM actually having to push uncomfortably far forward. There are pink wards on either side of his lane, so he doesn't have the vision he'd like, but he can play down there with Chaser. Just clearing out some Rek'Sai tunnels. Not going to have a nice opportunity to counteract that. And Chaser now moving down into Tribe Rush alongside Sweet. So Pilot the only one in lane right now.
Very hard to gank Nuclear with Valkyrie up, but it's possible.
I don't know, he can interrupt it with Kask.
That's Flash as well. Remember, all summoners and an Alistar for disengage finally show.
Here we go. Flash onto the Alistar. There's the cask onto Secret. Secret is just going to be exploded. He didn't have his ultimate yet. Now they're turning onto Nuclear. Is there much damage? Yes, another body slam comes through, and Pilot not going to get that one. Winter's Bite takes it away.
It's really poor use of the summoner spells by Nuclear as well. He did not need to die. Now, Secret wasn't quite level 6, so couldn't just wade away with the ultimate, but Nuclear overstayed, did some counter-harass, and now it's the freest dragon of their life.
Well, great timing, though. Sweet hitting level 6 first, right before Alistar did, so they can secure both of those kills. Sasin just walking around, I guess. He was seen, so not really a lot of kill pressure onto Trace. He was trying to make something happen, but Trace just immediately retreats.
These are not the solo lanes you want to play mid lane Jarvan against. Now, if this was Mara, he'd be overextended under the enemy turret. Maybe there's space for it. But when it's GBM and Trace, they're never overextended ever.
Yeah, you have to say maybe this is a misread on the way that Jhin'Erh likes to play the game.
Didn't read the instruction manual that came with the mid lane Jarvan, I don't think.
You actually just... It's an interesting discussion to talk about team style and how it affects drafting, but it doesn't really look like it was taken into account in this particular game. Pilot now with a couple of assists, not getting a kill. That's kind of a disappointment for him. Interestingly, Sweet going with Boots of Lucidity. That's actually interesting for a Braum, but it's really good with Kog'Maw.
It just means that you're unbreakable and your ultimate are available that more often. Of course, it's a 27-second cooldown. Your E, something comically large in the ult at level 1 as well. So, look, if it helps those all-in traits, it's fine.
Yeah, also just having the Winter's Bite up more often, too. That gives you just more and more time that you're able to actually get the stun off with a Bio-Arcane Barrage from the Kog'Maw.
So, answer a question, too. Which is the more disrespectful choice? The lack of arm guard on GBM, either as a rush or even now, or... You don't even feel pressured as Sweet to have the mobility boost to even be in the mid lane. They're just saying that, all right, we're happy with this Victor versus Jarvan matchup. He's even building an item like the cooldown reduction, but specifically for lane and with much worse roam opportunities.
I'm going to go with lack of arm guard.
Okay.
And directly leveling up his second hex core.
I mean, even CDR boots was his next purchase.
You know, sometimes you hope, like, players will get punished for this, but I love GBM's showboating in this game. It's interesting, and it really shows his character.
You don't need to... Oh, flash, pep up.
Yeah, there we go. Chaser punted out. Sasin is here. Can Chaser escape? There's an explosive cast. Looks like he will die. And there's a TP in. Equalizer already down. Trace arrives. Now, GBM's got everybody to choke, though. Can he do something with this? He does have Chaos Storm, but he's not... going to use it.
Sasin still has the ultimate available. Here it comes.
And there it goes. So it's Sasin trapped in there. Pilot at full HP right now. Trace is going to flash in. They're on top of Sasin. And there's the Chaos Storm finally. Is it a bit late? Kill picked up. Decathian Surprise not going to do much. Zunspenu making the most of this. Another use of the Death Ray.
Oh,
gravity field right there. Trace not dead. GBM low on mana. And nope, not going to work. Flash Death Ray. So he falls as well. That was a bit sloppy from Jynair. They had the opportunity to use the Chaos Storm. They held it too long.
Credit to Sars and his laning mechanics with the Jarvan were a bit off, but holding onto the ultimate, in particular the Cataclysm, then using it on the clumped up Hogmore and Braum, proved to be the winner. So an ace delayed for Spenu, and suddenly a window back into this game.
Yeah, that was nicely played by Spenu. First off, the engage, and only pilot there. Chaser really can't do much.
Target selection was very good, so Chaser died first. Crucially, didn't have to spend the ultimate, so flashed for auto attack range for Sarsen at this present point. They evaded the instant damage from the Victor ultimate, and then the re-engage came big.
Well, they should have just dropped Chaos Storm and retreated right there. There's no reason to lose more. Basically, it would have been a huge investment just for one kill and no objectives, but instead, they save it, and they only get that single kill, and then GBM gets really greedy.
He just doesn't realize that he doesn't have the mana for any more spells. At this point, well, it's almost completely out of mana.
It's a blind flash death ray onto Secret.
He was just smelling triple kill. The styling from the mid lane extended to that skirmish, and he was punished.
Well, even after the dust settles right there, Papa Smithy, it's still less than a 2K gold difference after that very poor team fight from Jynair. So they're not going to be too uncomfortable with that. And they also got the first dragon. So one of the major win conditions for Spenu has kind of already been denied.
Not impossible, but we're talking about 30 minutes being added to this game. We see the next one spawns in a minute 30, so 25 and a half minutes. So at the absolute earliest, a 42-minute dragon. And Spenu's average game time, it doesn't get close to 42 minutes.
No, it doesn't. And this composition can't survive at 42 minutes unless it's at 15k, 10k, 15k in advance. But they do get the top lane tower, that's nice. They use the Corki with the Trinity Force completed to take that objective, and now Pilot here will grab one on the opposite side of the map, so gold lead remains about the same. Are they going to commit to a dragon here, though? Spenu kinds of needs it. Yeah, that's where they're going to draw the line and back off.
Be interesting to see what defensive itemization Pilot goes for, because you know, you joked with Dora about the Randuin's AD carry, but maybe actually a decent pickup as we get into the later game, because not there's magic damage, but you're not really worried about the Rumble Corki. It's specifically Jarvan one-shotting you.
Yeah, or Corki getting in range after Jarvan goes in.
So remember, Corki has the armor shred with the flat armor penetration that we're expecting from the likely Brutalizer. True damage onto the Cogmo will be a very dead Void.
Yes. Well, Pilot does have flash up for the next fight, so harder to actually lock him down under these circumstances.
That ultimate going to be on a much shorter cooldown, so maybe it's about the repeated engage. It's blowing that flash and then knowing that for four and a half minutes, there's cooldowns that and just things that Pilot won't be able to account for in terms of the Cataclysm just locking down in position.
What do you think here for Jynair? I think they shouldn't fight this dragon. They should just take mid lane turret if they can so that Jarvan has to overextend. You don't need this dragon if you're Jynair.
Jarvan's woefully out of position at the moment. They have a couple of deep wards. He's just walked through a ward, so they have an idea of the positioning of the Jarvan. It's a risk, as you mentioned, but because you have the flash on Cogmo, if you can get that flash up on GBM as well, I think it's fair to contest.
Okay, well, Sassen will initiate a split push, at least for the moment. They want to get up to that tier two before they enter the river to fight the dragon. There you go. There's just a flash coming in. A Secret gets caught out. They know Jarvan's not there. Secret does take a large amount of chunk damage, but it's not too bad. Ooh, bad equalizer used. And they're just going to kite back into a choke. Spenu cannot follow that.
It was a nice equalizer. If the fight was different, it was in the right choke, but just wasn't able to force anything. Now, Jarvan has everything available and is at full health, but GBM still about 10 seconds away from his own flash.
They have no tankiness without Unbreakable, though. That's the main concern, and well, they're going to get the dragon. So Catch secures it with the smite. Jynair deciding not to re-engage, in spite of the fact that all the good ults right now from Spenu are down except for
Cataclysm. Very, very aggressive, but finally has to back away. Taking turrets, even with the Trinity Force on Corki, that's going to be the big difficulty for Spenu, because it's been a while since we've seen this, but it's a one-range champion line.
Yeah, and Maokai now heading down, but he only has the Ninja Tabi in terms of armor. Had to build for the Rumble in lane. Still no Righteous Glory. Sussan pops out. He's not going to get any turret damage down to speak of.
Still going to need an Infinity Edge on top of this Yomu's Ghostblade to realistically be able to kill someone like Maokai, even if it's only health and the Ninja Tabi. It's enough to hold down the job.
Wow, look at this. The actual Zonyas is starting to come through. He decided he was done being disrespectful. Actually got the arm guard.
Put in this place.
Yeah, just a little bit. Just a hair. But stacking that up later is not going to be ideal for him. Obviously, that's not really an efficient way to build when he already would have had the wave clear from the E with the first upgrade on the Hex Core and then been able to more fully stack it. So they're going to take a tower for it. And Spenu starting to develop a nice little chunk of change.
They've been holding Jhinnair at arm's length for the last 10 minutes or so. 3,000 gold it has been the consistent factor. And it is looking for spaces for Sarsen to split push and pick up items. But what is the crucial item pickup that really takes over this game? Yomu's Ghostblade obviously makes a lot of sense in terms of the flat armor penetration, but makes him an excellent and safe split pusher because, of course, EQing out at any opportunity and just popping the Yomu's for attack speed. Can they really go for that? Because they need to, specifically when teleport is down for Trace, I think that's a viable strategy. He's just not able to one-shot the tanky Maokai. So when the teleport's up, less options for the job.
Yeah, but even if he does start split pushing, GBM now picked up an early home guard, so he's kind of always going to be there. Now they could go for an early Baron, and if they get this, it will change absolutely everything. Pink's going down. It is seen with the scrying orb, so Spenu has to back off. Yeah, they really need to keep vision on that. Good instinct, though, as Pilot took the red.
That was a good aggressive call by Spenu as well.
Yep.
So it was a nice thing to try, especially with Corki in vision in the bot lane and with Sarsen being able to put out the massive damage, but they have to back away.
Well, back to Wave Clear Central here from Jhinnair as they just farm. Up into the items that they need to crush Spenu's composition.
Wave Clear Central sounds like a train station. Is it near KT?
Is it near KT? I don't know. I'm worried about KT. I would like to think that they're going to be continuing with their wave clear mission so they can play aggressively in the enemy jungle.
Spenu, a lot of pressure around this Baron, but this is one of those spots where you just feel like Spenu, because they're a younger team, because they don't have that experience, aren't going to be able to force the next step and the next piece in the puzzle, and are going to kind of let this Kog'Maw just free farm it up.
It's hard. It's really hard for them to actually do anything right now. Look at the way that Jhinnair is playing. Kog'Maw goes forward. They have three other people in that top side, and now they have to force the flash from GBM, but he's the one who's just standing there, and they can't actually take an objective. So they're getting the Kog'Maw the farm while playing in a defensive ring around him and just letting GBM sit there, wave clear, go back, home guard back into whichever wave needs him.
Still, we see that he's used the flash. Now you have something to play around, just like TF is very gankable under a turret. Victor is very immovable without the flash, and they have the Jarvan to really pin down his position. So,
well, until we get Zonyas, then that is not going to be so much of an option. Trying to bait the Baron now. Sweet is here. Sweet is going to get jumped on. There he goes, but nice flash out of the Cataclysm, so there's no kill. Spenu now less of a threat for the coming few minutes. But if that trade can go through, it will be useful.
Just want to force as many flashes as possible. About 90-second cooldown on the Cataclysm. Of course, the 5 minutes on the Baron is. Just use that Ghostblade to get out of lane. Easy peasy.
Well, very short cooldown, so probably not going to need that. You're not going to immediately be making a play as you look to farm up even further.
Use that word tempo to describe what Spenu needs to do this game. And the tempo of the last 5 minutes definitely leaves something a bit to be desired. And the gold lead, it's never grown. It's gotten to 2,500. It's pushed towards 3, but then kind of stood static.
It's that they're controlling the tempo, but not in a big enough way. They're getting these little itty-bitty victories. A flash for an ultimate here, things like that. But they're not taking home the big prizes, like Baron. Like any kind of tier 2 turret, they're not really able to fully commit to a split push. Zonya's Hourglass is now done on GBM. That is an absolutely massive buy. Kog'Maw is now the only target for Jarvan. That's it. because GBM will just simply put a gravity well on himself and Zonya's if you ult him. So there's nothing
field,
you can do.
Chaos Storm ultimate.
Yeah, yeah. Zonya's. So it's there's no real choice when it comes to how you're going to play this. You know that Pilot's the target.
It's only really Dragon that Spinner feels comfortable fighting around because, you know, you mentioned some of their options. Pushing turrets again with only the one ranged auto attacker is a tough feat for them to do without picks. And the defensive warding from Jhinnair, and this is a team known for many warding turns or just smart warding, has been there. And this is a second Dragon, something Jhinnair are happy to give away because, again, if this game is still going at 50 minutes, Jhinnair have other issues to deal with.
Jhinnair is playing to their win conditions right now. They know that getting that first Dragon is clutch. After that, they don't have to really commit to anything. They've doubled down in terms of home guard boots on their solo lanes. They're just going to sit there and wait and wait and wait for Sossin to be irrelevant, for Trace to start getting items like Frozen Heart.
And for Pilot to outscale Nuclear, because in terms of teamfight damage, that is something Kog'Maw will always do. And look at these item timings. Remember yesterday when Arrow was struggling in that matchup in game two between Ku and KT, he was an item behind or more for the majority of that game. In this game, Pilot's ahead.
Yeah, Pilot is ahead. Even GBM, at least in farm, has that slight edge. Same thing about Trace because they're splitting up. While Spenu repeatedly tries to group on this Baron to force some kind of fight, which is what they have to do. You know, they do need to accelerate the pace of this game somehow, some way.
Sossin's going to steal away the blue buff very, very quickly. Maokai's not interested. They have vision on this. They saw him step into this brush. But again, you talk about the wrestle for tempo, and it's just, it's too small. They need to make the big play. But with five flashes available, which will be the case very soon, hard for Spinner to make much happen because it's all Jarvan when we're talking about initiation.
Not even really going to be able to get this red buff right now with Jarvan on the bottom side of the map. They can only play around the Jarvan, pretty much.
That's exactly what Jhinnair is doing. They're sending the tanky Maokai there. Okay, doesn't have a lot of armor, but has a high enough amount of health and the likes of home guard boost just to ensure that no turrets will go down. And the Jarvan's movements have been predictable thanks to the smart warding from Sweet in particular.
Well, Jarvan can't even really walk up and auto these turrets either because Maokai will just walk behind him, arcane smash the wave, and then W to him, and he'll stand there next to the tower eating a bunch of turret shots.
Yep, that's the reality, and that's why we don't see a lot of this Jarvan. We don't crush lane, whether you're top or mid. Strategic options actually close down because you're used to high AP threat, you're used to range from the mid lane, and the turret pressure is only there. If it wasn't a Maokai, if it was a tanky, a carry-based top laner, absolutely consider the Jarvan. But in this particular case, kind of answered well by what Jhinnair's put together.
Yeah, certainly has been. Not to mention they have the Braum versus the Corki. That's a very favorable matchup too. Being able to block a lot of the phosphorus bombs in the laning phase, and then it chains into blocking some of those big rockets in the late game with the Unbreakable. Sossin has some more armor penetration now, but it's coming at a time where Chaser and Trace are really moving very rapidly towards Frozen Hearts.
Let's wait and see the first time Sossin and Trace meet in offlane, because level 16, two-level advantage over Trace, now with the Last Whisper. Maybe this is the time that you finally can hit that go button and actually pressure out the Maokai.
Well, they're not actually going for the Baron. Now, they're going to see Sossin. Lots of pings coming from Jhinnair onto that objective. They know they need to keep vision about it. And they're going to go on to Chaser, but there is no Jarvan there. Here's a TP actually coming in from the backside. TP is going to be meeting right there, but hello, Trace is already on top of Nuclear. And the Equalizer is dropped, but it's really not doing anything right now. Gravity Field ties up Secret, and that is one kill already for Jhinnair. Sossin wasn't ready to commit to that. There's the Maelstrom going in one more time. Sossin on the outside gets on top of Pilot. Pilot has Flash. He doesn't even have to use it as the concussive blows come through. GBM just wrecking alongside Trace, and that's a perfect ace. Double kill for GBM, and that is likely going to be the last chance that Spenu has. They tried to go aggressive without their key member, the mid lane Jarvan. What a disaster.
The tracking of the Jarvan was wonderful to see from Jhinnair. They split threats, Pilot and Sweet saying next to each other. Crucially, Sossin was exhausted before he even went through with the Cactus, but did no damage whatsoever. Just wait for the Jarvan to come into the picture, because again, he was the only one they really needed to account for.
Well, Trace is already there too. You can see Sossin using the Yomu's Ghost Blade, But where is he supposed to go right now? He knows he can only
hit
Tyler. Yeah, all flashes up. GBM just getting into the side lane.
Exhaust.
And there you go. Exhaust, like you said, down, jumping right over to the Kog'Maw. I mean, Pilot doesn't even have to use heal, doesn't have to use flash. Easy for Jhenair.
That's, look, what Jarvan needs is for so much disruption for the likes of a Gragas to maybe split up threats and then get that solo kill. Because if Braum is standing next to Kog'Maw, Kog'Maw's living.
Yeah. You don't even have to land a skill shot at that point. Well, they're going to try one more time. Equalizer, just a disengage from the Glacial Fissure. Secret dies all by himself.
Not that secret.
It wasn't that secret.
Full vision.
He's also a giant minotaur.
That's true. Larson's a damage threat, but not to Chaser. Now he's going to be caught.
And there we go. They're going to get some more auto attacks. He's going to get stunned. Here we go. The tank line is there. Sweet just blocking a lot of shots on the side. He's eventually going to go down, trying to get under his tower. But where is the next Twisted Advance? Well, pops his ultimate onto the tanks. That is not going to work. Pilot there to throw in a few auto attacks.
I'm just impressed with how smartly Jhenair have played around something different, played around the mid lane Jarvan that you see from time to time in solo queue and in other scenes, but it's not often in the mid lane when we're talking about competitive teams outside of Keen. And accounting for those picks, a secret force super low is probably going to die even through the Unbreakable Will.
Well,
quit to see.
Yeah, Pilot has so much damage right now. You know what? I actually disagree with Pilot's build. I have no idea why he built the Last Whisper here. He should have just gotten Infinity Edge or even Bloodthirster for more protection against the Jarvan.
I'm going to put those rose tinted glasses on, say he wanted to kill Alistair on Unbreakable Will. That's fine. Very good use of gold.
No, it's percent damage reduction.
Still doing damage.
It's not as good as Infinity Edge.
Shush you. I don't know. He's just buying whatever, because unfortunately, those purchases don't really mean a lot in the context of this game. Assassin has been so expertly played around that even he, the one that all the resources have been funneled to on Spenno, is a non-factor.
Yeah. I still like to see better AD carry itemization than this. But you're right. It really not going to matter at this point. Spenno down at 32 minutes. One Frozen Heart done for Trace. Chaser going to be finishing his up very, very soon with that Warden's Mail. And not really a whole lot that they can do right now, especially with Pilot retaining all of his summoners. This is about what you can do. Stand in a bush and pray.
Yeah. Divine Intervention. It's always something to really hope for on the Rift.
Regame due to blackout.
Stranger things have happened. We watched Season 2 Worlds. Crazy things happened there.
Yes, I too remember sitting at LA Live at like the ESPN Zone or wherever it was, listening to 8 hours of Silver Scrapes on a loop throughout the entire restaurant sound system. That was a good time. It wasn't annoying at all.
I will not let you talk down Silver Scrapes, Monte Cristo.
Literally, just Silver Scrapes.
Yep.
For 8 hours, on a loop. It was horrible.
IEM Events, also famous for song loops. Don't think I can say the name of that song on the stream, unfortunately. Sad days. I thought about it. I didn't want to commit to it.
Oh, I'm sorry, Papa Smith.
What do you do about a phone? Android something?
How about that? I'm a gamer loop. That's a fun one.
Loops.
WCG though, beyond the game.
See, that was the outline. Tell me you weren't hyped by Beyond the Game.
I mean,
even in an ironic sense.
I'll admit, some small part of me maybe misses Beyond the Game just a little bit. I don't think we're ever going beyond the game again.
No. There wasn't WECG last year, is there?
No, it didn't actually happen, Smithy. It didn't actually happen.
Events in China, sometimes like that. Just like Ku versus EDG.
Yeah.
Didn't actually happen.
It didn't actually? Is it going to happen?
No. Probably there was a mistranslation.
Oh, that's sad. That would have been interesting to see. I don't think Ku would have done very well, but there you go.
Ammunition denied.
I really don't think that in EDG and Ku's current state that Ku would be able to survive very long against EDG, considering they are weak to the early game, and that is one of EDG's primary strengths.
can't disagree with that logic at all, but I'm sad that it's not happening. I miss the days of the Gigabyte Stars World League and these Korea versus China tournaments. We have to wait for Worlds. I mean, MSI, of course, to give us a lot of data points there, but, you know, those rare inter-regional matches just teased and then not happening.
Well, Baron going to be up in another minute, so Jhin'Air looks like they want to secure that objective before they actually commit to breaking the base. They have pretty good siege, so I'm not sure that's entirely necessary, but they want to play the ultra, ultra safe game, and this 2-0 is super important to them, so that is quite understandable.
As you mentioned, everything is tied up between 2nd and 6th, so given especially Jhin'Air, no guarantee to make it into the top five. They're one of the most likely teams to miss the playoffs. Now's the time to play the really measured game. And honestly, they didn't start this game measured. We saw the taunting from GBM in the laning phase. And remember, all those five kills were the delayed ace at 8-10 minutes into the game randomly. But since then, they've buttoned up a bit.
They have. I love the confidence they started this game with, though. Simply GBM getting into his opponent's head. Well, you missed that first Dragon Lance. I'm going to start slash laughing and slash dancing on you. Showing that level of confidence. Well, they're standing in a ward right now. It doesn't really matter because there is a Rek'Sai bet.
Ooh.
That does not see the green ward, so they pop the lens on it anyway.
Is it wrong that I try and imagine how that could happen in real life? Those weird visual bugs.
Yep. Here we go. Dragon spawns. Jhin'Air immediately on it. Trays with an Iron Elixir. He's a big, huge, huge mega tree. And can he find the angle? Almost certainly he will be able to, depending on where he chooses to TP into. Secret there with the Righteous Glory, gonna get a nice knockup, but there is no follow-up whatsoever. And guess what? Baokai's already here. Secret will die, and the Equalizer just not doing enough. They get a kill on the sweep, though. So that is a nice little bonus for them, but they just, oh! Nope, that's not gonna work. Pilot actually goes down to Corki somehow. Oh, a little bit too far forward. Nuclear still at full HP. Now, are they going to be able to turn this? Nicely done by Spenu. Triple kill onto Nuclear. They didn't find the right targets in the back line.
Specifically, Pilot could not walk over the Equalizer, so had to back away. Was split from his tanks and the other threats. GBM was able to Zonya's out the damage from the Jarvan ultimate, but that's the exact sort of unorganized fight that Spenu was looking for.
And Jhin'Air, they haven't been the best team at team fighting, it has to be said, this season. And now they have to deal with Trace. Trace has a lot of HP still, but Sassen is doing a lot of damage. And looks like Trace is going to fall in the end. However, he did buy time for Victor to get there, so doesn't make that big of a deal considering that the Baron was stopped and Jhin'Air will simply have another shot at it.
Definitely mission successful from Trace's perspective. His job was to stop Baron. He did that expertly. There's still a small remote chance that Spenu can get back into this game, but honestly that was more on Jhin'Air's positioning misplays, playing around a choke.
Well, all they have to do is just disengage off of Secret.
But instead they all sit on the Equalizer. Now, even though this is not a massive Equalizer in terms of damage, Pilot's first instinct is to go back, and who's there but Jarvan?
Nuclear gets a ton of free auto attacks over the wall, too.
And this Jarvan accounts for GBM in general. As you mentioned, Nuclear completely able to free auto. Cogmore, first instinct to move back from the Equalizer, stopped any chance of a teamfight win for Jhin'Air. They pick up the dragon, though, but that's actually Spenu's dragon, but 3-2, as we mentioned. Fifth dragon, not a realistic win condition this game.
Yeah, not going to really be there for them. Now, the Baron could very well be, and Jhin'Air not in a place to contest it if Spenu chooses to rush it. They've got three people still in the mid lane, but looks like Spenu, are they going to commit right away? The answer is no.
Has there been any big item purchases? Infinity Edge, although it sounds comical, is pretty core to this Jarvan build because you can do insane burst damage with all the armor shed from both your Q and the Last Whisper. He's gone for the Ravenous Hydra just for a bit of extra sustain. I don't know if he needs sustained damage. It feels like his job is to really account for Pilot in particular, who still has built no defensive stats. He doesn't have any health, he doesn't have any armor. He is still very easy to kill, specifically for the next 2.5 minutes while his flash is down.
Yeah, Pilot 2 just really punished for his misuse of his summoner spells. You know, you think about it, he could have actually repositioned earlier in that fight by flashing over the Equalizer and just getting into a position behind his tank line, but instead he walked out and then flashed straight into Nuclear and Soul's damage. So that was a pretty big misplay. Pilot just gonna shoot over the wall right now. This ultimate's gonna miss a lot, actually.
Sweet, single-handedly just sitting there with the sight stone, plopping down wards and stopping the Baron threat. That should be easy. Remember, Pilot doesn't have any way to get to this Baron fast. This is the sort of time when Spenna really want to be pushing onto the Baron, but so far, completely unable to.
Yeah, they're prepping there. Remember that if Pilot has to go right now, his mana will be low. So not ideal. Man, if Spenna can win this game, it is going to be absolutely crazy, their comeback.
Catch gets caught, but able to get through with the tunnel. Very nice. So
Glory used, though.
And Pilot also, as you mentioned, below half mana. Now, of course, Biocane Barrage no longer costs mana, but it's all about that consistent damage. And even just the reveal, allowing your allies to be able to get extra auto attacks and just spells in. So it's actually a relevant factor. It's at half now, so it's not panic stations, but it's been a need to force something.
I think they're just going to wait until Pilot summoners are back up. There's no reason not to, really.
That's why it's going to need to. They have the exact timer. They'll know when Pilot flashes up because it's pretty much key to their victory that summoner is down.
Yes. At least the current time, without any kind of survivability for Pilot beyond what his allies can help him with.
Elixir of Wrath on Sarsen also bought another longsword, as powered up as he can be with his current economy. Spender's only place to fight is around Baron because they cannot push. We've mentioned this multiple times. There's good wave clear from Jyn Air, and there's no safe turret damage from Spender.
It's like a recall for Pilot. What will he buy? Okay. He's going to buy a cowl. Well, I suppose that gives him some health, but.
Okay, what this lets him do, okay? Bear with me here. He can now stand on the equalizer and not have to flash away from it. So if that means that he can disregard one of these zone control abilities and just ensure his flash is specifically to deal with Jarvan, that's still more than he can buy in items in many other regards.
Fair. One could also argue that perhaps distortion enchantment on his boots might be useful this game.
I don't know if he needs to worry about his next flash. I feel like the next team fight will decide this game. It feels like Spenu were already one foot in the grave. Now they have a fighting chance, but I don't think it's really an important point, Pilot's subsequent flash, because the next fight's going to decide everything.
Well, they're looking for it now. Pilot's flash is back up. It would seem to be the trigger for Jyn Air to actually do this Baron.
Sarsen doesn't have flash himself. It looks like it's about, what, 10 seconds away? So 10 summoners going to be available very, very shortly.
Now, they can't see the Baron directly, but Rek'Sai will see a bunch of people milling around with the Tremor Sense after that Void Rush. So not really worried about it. Jyn Air really waiting a long time, and now
nice from Sarsen.
The split push from Sarsen.
Super safe. He has EQ to get away. They will get this turret.
Yep. And he's going to just walk down through the bottom side jungle.
You cannot pick this guy. He has a Yoma's Ghost Blade for the 10% movement speed, so doesn't even have to blow that. Can just walk away. So nice little turret picked up. Again, closing the gold gap. Only 3,000 gold is the advantage. As for once, Jyn Air have a lot of control around Baron. Understandably, no confidence in starting.
Well, Jyn Air, they really do like to play defensively. They wait and they wait and they wait. Sometimes to their own detriment, as six items come in and the game becomes a lot more of a toss-up. Now, it's in this case, six items is not much of a toss-up for them, so they actually don't have much to lose by continuing to wait here.
Don't make any big macro decision-making flaws, Jyn Air. Last time we watched them, I had to talk about cricket a lot. So far,
oh man, that was a bit questionable in that mid-game. Get that early inhibitor for free, inhibitor turret, and
yeah,
then
take
just never actually split push the inhibitor, the naked one.
Yeah, take a top lane inhibitor turret at 15 minutes. Take down that top lane inhibitor for the first time at 43 minutes. That was the worst.
That was.
It was really bad.
Well, QSS finished for Sarsen.
I think damage. Honestly, I think he needed a BF sword.
Especially since there's going to be a delay on the actual CC, except for the Twisted Advance. But the concussive blows and the gravity field do take time to actually CC you. And if you haven't done enough by that moment, you're probably not going to do much at all.
So hard unless other zone control ultimates come in and actually force one of these summoners down. Trace actually goes aggressive.
They're going for it. Nope. Righteous Glory used, but there we go. He's on to Pilot already, but there's the flash. So now Jyn Air can go in. Trace doing a lot of damage. Sasan really doesn't have much. He's just being blocked out on the side. Equalizer comes through. They're on top of Pilot. Can they kill Pilot? They can kill Pilot as Soul gets on top of him. Victor, the only damage left now. And holy cow, is Spenu going to turn this?
Yes.
They've killed three. Chaser is actually going to go down. Sweet, the only one remaining. And they're going to be able to just push through and win this game.
60-second death timers. Sasan did his job, got on and absolutely zoned Pilot away from the whole fight. Rek'Sai even picks up the fifth kill. This is a win for Spenu.
A shocking comeback from Spenu here as they just pick apart Pilot. Pilot just doesn't have the necessary tools to escape. You got to wonder about this build a little bit. He only had to stay alive. And they really overcommitted on the flank too and left Pilot alone. They tried to get on to catch, and that's going to be a shocking upset for Spenu. And now Sasan giving it back with the dancing in the Nexus. I love it. I love it.
So much feeling in what was a nothing match for Spenu. They could have just rolled over and died. They were behind 5,000 gold to a mid lane Jarvan. But crucially in that fight, the damage registered onto Pilot, he was chunked out to below half.
No one was there to peel for him.
But his positioning, he was trying to get free orders. He did not think the Sasan would just run straight at him, but that was a positioning mistake from Pilot. And when he flashed away, his Bio-Arcane Barrage was down as well. So he did precisely zero damage while Corki free hit.
Well, Chaser tried to get back there too, but it was just too late. I mean, that is pretty airtight. You should not lose in that situation, but Jhin Air found a way to do it.
Honestly, it's nice to see someone being put to the sword. It wasn't necessarily GBM in particular, but Jhin Air took that game far too lightly, and that's why it's good to see them pay for it. And now we can just put those first two games away. Now it's just a best of one for all the marbles. And if Jhin Air lose, I mean, basically all their hopes for October play, for even September play, are gone.
Yeah, unless there's another equally shocking upset, but you kind of don't think that one's coming through. And Jhin Air, they had a bit of a gimme here, because guess what? Najin still has to play SK Telecom. They haven't done that in the second round robin yet.
This was the gimme, absolutely. The difference was one team had to play Spenu, the other one had to play SK Telecom. Crazy to think that the results might be paired or then some in those two series. Just wait and see what Jhin Air does on the blue side this time around. They've banned away the Alistar.
Yeah, they didn't pick it in the first game first. They took the Rek'Sai and took the Alistar in the second round of the draft.
We're seeing Rek'Sai on blue side.
Okay, that's interesting. I wonder what they want to go for here. And so they mix up their bans. It was in the first game, Ezreal, Gragas, and Riven. But since Sora is no longer in this series, the Riven becomes a bit freer, and it will be a Nidalee. So Ryze may be the first pick. Okay, interesting. What is Spenu's plan?
So clearly they had to choose between the Ryze and the Nidalee, given how strong Jhin Air on poke. You know, if you force them to go for this 5v5 team fight comps, they can make mistakes in the late game. They're pretty assured on the Nidalee, but it's a high price to pay giving up the Ryze.
Well, they do deny three top-tier junglers from Chaser, though, which is intelligent in its own right, as they take the Victor 2, so GBM is going to have a different solution.
Twisted Fate doesn't make it through picks and bans. Those are the two champions you've been playing a lot of, the likes of Victor, Twisted Fate, and I guess Cassiopeia would be his other frequently played mid. He'd need to find a jungler with decent pressure. And, you know, it's not necessarily a favorable matchup. It's definitely one you can opt into. And I guess there is the potential that it's a Ryze mid, so we shouldn't necessarily pigeonhole our thinking too much.
I don't think you show the Ryze mid this early in the draft, though. You take your jungler right here. It will be the Evelynn. There's no Rek'Sai on the other side, so less risk. And Chaser has been decent about getting some of those flanks in. Meanwhile, Corki could be the choice here from Pilot, going back to an old staple.
Now will Spenu pick up the Kog'Maw? They have decent zone control. No. It's engage time, clearly, with the Sivir Annie.
Yep. And they want to go for the kill pressure immediately. Try and play full tilt right here. And I think that's a good plan. How did they beat last time? They had the engage, and Jhin Air just fell apart in terms of their positioning.
Jhin Air going to have to show their mid lane. It could still loom to be the Ryze. One of the things that this comp puts together is a lot of relying on Trace to carry, and we've mentioned that's not been one of the modes that Jhin Air operate on. It's been all about Chase. There's no saying that he can't carry from the jungle as Evelynn, but A lot relying on the rise.
I'm actually surprised we didn't see the Echo, Papa Smithy, for Chaser, because the chain of the Rune Prison into the Parallel Convergence is very strong, but I guess it will be a mid-lane rise, something we've seen this season from the likes of Faker, but not common.
Well, it's the Maokai's locked in to know for sure. I agree with you on the side of...
Echo's definitely a better choice now with Maokai.
And yeah. Leona.
No, it's way better.
It definitely is, but you feel like Chaser, you know, it's a champion that should fit both Jhin'er, who loves to run poke comps, you know, the zone control that Echo can put out, even if you're building full tank. It should fit their comps. Ever since we saw Score really run over Chaser's Echo, the one time he played it in the series between those two teams, he just hasn't come back to it, even though it does feel like the sort of champion that Chaser can put damage out on, can be a tanky threat. It should be in the Jhin'er playbook. It's just been completely discounted.
Yeah, it has been. But again, you have kill pressure in all the lanes with Echo right now.
Please, Sol, do it.
And would we see our first Singed?
I don't think so, but it's not a bad matchup for him. Maokai, Shen, both decent matchups. Shen is definitely the preferential one, but it's probably not going to be that. But will he go Fizz hunting? Because he does have the Fizz summoner spells in the top lane.
Could be Hecarim too, depending. Gnar. Okay, well, that was a bit of a wacky last-minute shift, but it does provide them with some nice secondary engage to follow up on Annie and Gragas, as well as that winning matchup versus the Maokai. So everything's on GBM right now. He's going to have to scale. They are going to have some mid-game punch with the Corki and the Maokai picks.
A lot of scaling on the side of Jhin'er, specifically from GBM in the mid lane. Of course, Maokai going to likely build into the Righteous Glory as well. A lot of immediate power coming through from Spenu, but... Look, they had an engage-heavy comp and made it work in game two. Just need to go right back to that playbook and do it again.
Yep, and if they are as confident in their team fighting capabilities and their ability to catch Jhin'er off guard and really punish them for further positioning errors, this may be the composition to do it with. Now, there's a ton of engage from Jhin'er, though. Leona, Evelynn, Maokai. So they are going to be much more effective in that regard. Ryze shouldn't have trouble at least getting onto the front line at minimum in this particular game.
Agreed, but the Evelynn is kind of the question mark. Ryze mid against Victor. Victor will definitely have the early wave play advantage. Plus, Ryze can just get superpowered and clear waves decently, but if Victor can really run this mid, if they can take GBM's turret, then there's a lot of counterplay for Spenner.
Yeah, there is. There is. Maybe tough to do, especially with that Corki powering up early and presenting a turret threat of his own. We are about to get into game three, Jhin'er versus Spenu. Here we are again, Papa Smithy. Spenu 1-1. They're still looking for that first best of three win. They're fighting for pride right now, but I'm sure it would mean the world to them to actually beat Jhin'er in this best of three.
Not halting GBM's dance moves just yet on the Dark Crystal Rise. This was once a banned skin, I believe, but finally back into competitive. What's your take on the Dark Crystal Rise?
Yeah. I'm not really into the Ryze skins.
Everybody, come on, Zombie Ryze is cool.
Zombie Ryze is cool. I agree with that.
Where's your patriotism?
No, I don't. I think the Uncle Ryze is overused.
Okay.
It's overused.
That's fair.
So I'm appreciative of the scarcity, relatively, of the Dark Crystal Ryze. I like the Pirate Ryze skin.
With his cannon?
Yeah. I don't know how he reads that into spells. Maybe it's engraved on the cannon itself.
I feel like that one's not really very lore appropriate. Hey.
That's okay. Nobody cares about the lore anyway.
Fair.
Except when they disable champions that are enabled on the tournament realm for some reason, so no one can practice them in ranked.
I knew you'd go there, Monte Cristo.
I think that's not a great idea.
But Gangplank died, Monte Cristo.
But if he's still enabled for tournament usage, you should be able to actually practice him.
But he's dead.
I don't care.
Jhin'er actually walked into this brush. They haven't been found.
Oh, the cheese is real. Secret eats a bunch of damage, and that is that risk. I like that we're seeing the Corki Leona lane come back, Papa Smitty. It's Worlds time, almost. So Corki Leona back in the meta, naturally.
Corki never left the meta, but Leona is one of these champions that has the very strong laning phase against the Annie. Now with the early harass, they have a significant minion advantage. Secret needs to be so defensive because a level 2 burst is real, and Chase is here as well.
Man, the cheese is so, so fresh this game, but Chase are not going to commit to that. It would be really difficult to get in for a gank right there.
Isn't fresh cheese worse?
Yes, it's far worse. You want to age it. But it's fresh in this game because
it's early.
It hasn't been aged yet. There's no late game cheese.
That wasn't just some urban lingo, the freshest of cheese.
Suppose we could go there. And look at this, an invade coming in right now. Sweet is there to provide some harassment, but he will be backed up by Secret. Catch level 2, so is Sweet, and he's going to try and just be as annoying as he possibly can be. Now, we do see Chaser wrapping around the side. Are they going to go for this? There's the Zenith Blade pushing him forward, but Sweet can't really do much more than that.
Smart of him to hold on to the Body Slam till as the animation was going through, so it couldn't be canceled. So nice mechanics, opens up a lot of distance away from the Leona, removes any pressure from Jeanette.
Well, Chaser not going to get much, though, in spite of his attempts this early on. He's actually going to be behind in levels now without that blue buff. GBM pushing up, but immediately getting out of there as Catch thinks about making a play over the Raptor wall. That'll push right back towards him, and he evades an early gank on this Ryze. Has taken Ghost.
No combat summoners for lane. Obviously, we'll help him get away from ganks, but this is a really necessary spell to get into fights in the late game especially.
So Chaser finally going to take a delayed blue buff. Catch gets the first recall, so he will be back out on the map sooner. And Soul not putting a lot of harassment down on a Trace yet. Of course, this matchup really does favor Gnar once you actually get the Hex Drinker. Before that, it's not quite so easy.
It's also just a really hard lane for Trace to itemize in, because the Maokai is kind of split between the three item purchases. Health, and you're going to get whittled down by the Gnar W, the Hyper. If you build armor, which is kind of the thing that you'd most expect, given the Boomerang Toss does exclusively physical damage, then the Hyper damage is magic damage. So it's just very hard to itemize. You kind of want both the Catalyst, the Shroud, and also the Spectre's Cowl. And that's obviously a really big investment. Speaking of investments, a lot of time being used by Catch. Secret has the flash and the stun proc'd, but not quite enough spacing for Catch to become involved.
Well, they just have no idea where Chaser is. They want to punish Sweet for posturing pretty aggressively here, but there is an element of risk to that, and it looks like actually they just want to push forward, and Catch is only playing defensively, so Nuclear and Secret will just fall back and open up an opportunity to shop. And Catch just, they're waiting on the counter gank in case he's needed.
Still actually falling behind in experience despite the fact that Chaser spent a lot of time around lanes very early into the game. So I'm sure he'll catch up soon. He's close to level 4, yeah, Pops level 4 himself. So not much to speak about between the junglers. Not quite BF Sword Gold in bot lane either.
Wow, GBM just standing right in the fountain right there. Waits for his tier. He's a bit late in getting it, but still early enough. And meanwhile, there's a surprisingly large CS lead for Trace in the top side. Looks like Soul not playing this matchup very aggressively early, and Trace eking out a few extra CS.
We often see a lane swap to get Maokai out of this 1v1, so surprising to see Trace so on top of the matchup. No defensive wards from either team. I guess the fact that you can't ward against Evelynn makes it just that much more risky, because of course targeted CC into the very high early base damages of Evelynn might mean death for the Gnar. He's going to transform into Mini Gnar very soon. I think a dive would be optimistic, but still possible from Evelynn and Mount.
Well, there is that one longsword, and they don't have any information right now. Actually, Soul got down to about 50% during that trade, so Trace taking advantage of the Mega Gnar form to get in and get close. And they are going to try to dive, but look at Catch. He's right here. Can they get it done in time? And they're going to go down. Soul is actually just going to fall, or is he? There you get the first blood. Trace will flash out. Catch cannot come through. And He is going to back off through his minion line right now to avoid any kind of body slamming. Oops. Well, not sure if that was supposed to hit Trace or not. A little bit of a threat of a turnaround right there, but they barely get that kill. Chaser picks it up.
Catch had the right idea coming to help Soul, but just couldn't take the most direct route. I believe he tried to body slam over to the golems and maybe didn't find one because, of course, that camp's been ruined earlier by Chaser. So, nice dive coming through for First Blood, and it'll probably just cement further Maokai's lane ascendancy over Gnar.
Especially with that cowl purchase from Soul. So, he's going for a very defensive build. We rarely see this on Gnar in this matchup, but that's basically capitulating to losing the lane now.
Yeah, we've seen solo kills for Maokai versus Gnar. Certainly shouldn't be the norm, but with a purchase like that, without the Hex Drinker to even threaten damage, the hyper damage only becomes relevant around level 12 when you can finally put 5 points into that ability in the early game. It's just going to be free farm for Trace, and you think that's going to be Righteous Glory and teamfight wins for Jhin'Erh, even with the Ryze powering up till much later in the game.
Yeah, and Chaser has a chance to gank that lane again, too, because there's no armor or anything. I mean, basically, Trace is going to be at full HP, and Chaser will have damage. So, it's looking pretty promising. And here we go. Nuclear does get the spell shield down. They force the ultimate out. Chaser is there. Can they follow it up? Yes, they can. Nuclear is going to be dove underneath the turret. Summerheal not going to be enough. TP's now coming in. There's a big Gnar ult, but it's not going to be enough to kill Chaser. However, the Ignite will take him down. Finally, we see Catch coming in, but there's no more damage. They do trade one for one. And GBM chasing Sossin around in the river.
Surprising to see Catch back away just because Victor was going to respond first, but I guess respecting the fact that Ghost and Flash, the two mobility summoners, means that GBM might have just been more reliable in impacting that fight with all the flashes down. The big factor was that Secret actually got the CC onto Sweet, so he wasn't able to use his Q and any follow-up CC despite having a huge amount of it as Leona. That's what opened the distance, got the kill trade. It was nice play for Spenu in a bad situation.
Yeah, well, the one-for-one trade is decent, but, I mean, trading your AD carry for the jungler is not exactly optimal. Chaser got the kill, though, so the gold not going necessarily to the right places on Jhin'Erh, but neither could be said for Spenu, just the support taking the Ignite kill as it ticked off as Chaser ran away, so it's kind of a wash.
We have this issue in the top lane with Soul. You have to assume he had that 1200 gold rather than the 1350 for the Hex Drinker. Went for laning stats, but pigeonholes him into team fight Gnar, which everyone knows is just not a reliable option. You need to have the split push threat and the big team fight Gnar, because one out of four times maybe you get that Gnar against the wall, but more reliably, you just, it's so much to work around for both your team and so much information for the enemy team to really play around your power positions in a fight.
To be fair, having teamfight Gnar is probably the best. If you have to build this way, at least you have an Annie to set it up.
Sure.
Right. That Annie is probably the best possible support, or really any position that you could have. We could say maybe Sejuani, but Sejuani not really in the meta right now. You need someone to reliably set up a big crowd control so you can follow up on it with the Gnar. So, as far as this situation goes, not great, obviously, but it definitely is a lot better than it could be.
You could argue that, of course, Jhin'Erh's teamfight positioning, they opted into 4-5-man equalizers a lot of the previous game, and their teamfights in general have been pretty poor, highlighted by Pilot being assassinated in the last fight in game two. There's the go button.
And Sweet just going to get bursted down immediately. There's a big actual, oh, look at that. Sweet was going to walk away. Now, are they too low? Looks like the Agony's Embrace coming down, but they don't have the speed to catch anyone else. And a flash from the Boomerang Blade. Nice engage there. Nuclear and Secret just willing to pull that trigger. Sweet tanky and got a nice solar flare, but it wasn't enough.
Pick up another kill. Good play from Spenus. Pressed the go button, didn't even use the Gragas ultimate. Not sure if it was off cooldown, but picked up the kill. But yeah, it was millimeters away from two answering kills for Jhin'Erh.
It's not actually doing that much work as we take a look. Look how much more farm Chaser has right now. He is just ripping through the jungle with the early Warrior Gem, and now he's behind. There's actually a gank in the bottom lane right now into Sivir. We're not going to see it, but Nuclear dies.
Yep. That was without an Agony's Embrace. That must have just been a huge overextension without summoners by Nuclear.
Well, you have the Warrior Enchant, and you have the Sheen. So there's a lot of damage there, and Nuclear had no summoners, no ultimate.
No life.
No life.
See the Reaper? Ah, it was the ward that was the big factor. Got a bit greedy trying to poke out Pilot and died.
Yep. Pretty straightforward. Enough speed and gap closers there to make the difference. So Pilot will pick up his first kill of the game. Jhin'Air still with a substantial gold lead. They have farm leads in top, in jungle, and in bottom. Particularly that jungle one is really big already. He's a sight stone ahead. That is very big.
That is huge. And in the mid lane, it's the expected small advantage from Sarsen as Ryze powers up, gated by items so much as this Ryze in the early game. So going better than expected in the laning phase for Jhin'Air.
Yeah, definitely. Soul trying to harass Trace, but it's not that effective right now. And Sweet just here lurking. Catch is also going to be coming through. We see that Chaser takes the red buff. No Agony's Embrace, but Explosive Cask up for Catch.
Shorter cooldown. Catch didn't use it in the previous fight. Will we just see the ultimate again? Chaser is level 9 to the level 7 of Catch.
Right, and if this ult comes off cooldown, which it will right now, they're going to wait for this to push forward. Catch a little bit leery. They've got great wards everywhere except for that Tri-Brush, so Catch can still slip in there, but he's going to have to lane gank.
It's up level 8 in the Gromp buff. That's still something for Gragas in what may be a massive 3v3 skirmish.
Here we go! Solar Flare! Nope. Well, they popped the Spell Shield and the On the Hunt immediately, but a flash burned actually from Secret. That's nice so that they can't, Jhin'Air can't get all in the bottom again.
Flash being down on Annie just removes that reliable flash tibbers engage. No distortion boost. That's 5 minutes where it's going to be just that much more offensive in the bot lane for Jhin'Air.
Jhin'Air may be going for round two. They actually did not burn the Evelynn ultimate, so they could in fact deal with that. Now we do see Spenu starting to move into the river with Ryze back inside his base. It's a nice Rod of Ages timing, though. GBM's been getting some really good farm. He's been really not harassed very significantly.
24 minutes. That's, and we'll see the 10 set. That is very early.
Nice, especially with the tier first.
Seraph's Embrace won't be that far behind, so things looking good for GBM. Only has the Ghost available. Chase is looking for the turret dive. Solar Flare cooldown at level 1, not quite the super short cooldown of late game, but just considering their options around bot lane at Jhin'Air.
Yeah, they're still waiting to power up a little bit with this Trinity Force. Jhin'Air going to have a very smooth power spike, actually, a very smooth power curve, I should say, because they'll have the Trinity Force, and that's going to lead directly into Ryze finishing his Rod of Ages stacks and his Seraph's Embrace.
Chaser once again inching towards a fight. Victor once again is going to be the first one to react. A lot of pressure around bottom lane, but nobody willing to pull the trigger.
Yeah, Catch has been playing around bottom very heavily in all the games tonight.
Precisely on top of a ward. He's got that Raptor buff and start clearing out those wards. He's been very predictable in his positioning. Soul's been losing the 1v1 trades, as we would have expected, given his item build. Still only has a longsword in terms of laning statistics.
Well, I'm actually surprised that he's even going for the longsword at this late of a stage. It seems like there's already been a missed opportunity.
Maybe a phage for just a bit of movement in fights. I don't know if phage or Hex Drinker really does a lot more work, but yeah, I agree with you. At this present point, if you miss that, what, 8 minute timing for your Hex Drinker or the very early first laning purchase, just build a Banshee Veil. Guarantee that Gnar ultimate if the team really communicates around your Gnar bar effectively.
Yeah, Pilot playing really far back now. They don't want to eat another Tippers if they can avoid it, and they don't have Chaser there. He is busy handing off the blue buff, so that's not really going to give Catch an opportunity to gank. He's still down in that bottom side. Yep. They get found out.
It's a super early scrying orb from Pilot, but level 9 already. It's going to have the larger range and the shorter cooldown.
Yeah, it's a nice pickup. Definitely doing work this early on into the game. Well, no dragon taken yet. Spenu probably should think about maybe committing to that. Soul actually got a red buff in this top side, so it looks like he was the designated one. And honestly, with Catch just spending his entire time on the bottom side of the map, you might as well just give it over so you can get some more harassment here and maybe start to win this lane in a more convincing fashion, because right now it's pretty even.
Yeah, it's a good allocation of resources actually by Spen. Say, all right, I'm not spending any time in top barring smiting my Raptor buff. GBM with the wraparound gank not spotted out at all. And he's going to charge up that passive as well. Oh, boy.
Oh, no. And Soul actually hops forward. It couldn't come at a worse time. Now he discovers, hey, there's a rise in my lane, and he's got Ghost. Soul going to do what he can, but no one's even near a wall, and he doesn't even hit GBM. GBM just destroys him. So Spenu going to get a dragon, but frankly, I don't think Jhin'Air actually cares. That kill on the rise is so valuable in the early game.
Anything to power up those stacking items is massive for Jhin'Air. Back and uncontested, although Jhin'Air poking around afterwards, there's the engage.
Trying to cut off catch, it's not really going to work though, and a quick gravity field. They're still going for it. Trace actually going to follow up all the way onto catch. They see the catch is low, explosive cast goes through. There's the Agony's embrace, but I don't know if Jhin'Air really wants this fight. Trace still there. I mean, GBM is not here at all.
They're opting into a 5v4. There's the Gnar teleport. Now he's only in mini Gnar form, but it's coming in quick.
Wow, I have no idea why you would take that fight if you are Jhin'Air.
Soul completely couldn't decide between which threat. He's probably going to take down Chaser, waiting for one more auto attack. Yes, gets the kill.
And now, Spenu able to group in the mid lane. GBM got a turret, but they weren't going to get that whether they took that fight or not. Now they're trading a turret for a turret, and it is mid lane at that. The one that they really would have liked to have kept up with this rise. That is an insanely poor trade for Jhin'Air. At this stage of the game, they gave up a kill, they gave up a dragon, they gave up their mid lane turret for a top lane turret.
Yeah, they would have got that top lane turret regardless, but the top lane turret for Dragon Trade, which honestly, for a team that, you know, picking up gold, getting items onto Ryze is pretty ideal.
Especially since they got a kill onto him too.
And now it's so much more for Spenu. They're going to push bottom lane as well. Sweet's there to pick up the minion wave though, so no extra turrets or extra objectives for Spenu.
Wow, really questionable decision making. They knew, too, that Soul was coming back up with his TP available, so it was quickly turned into a 5v4. And GBM, at the very least, got some farm, but that is not worth it at all.
And let's be clear, GBM is super strong, already has the Archangels, still stacking both of his stacking items, but they're probably going to be finished around the same time, if not an Archangels earlier. So accounting for this rise in fights, still not something Spenu has shown they're really going to be able to do.
Well, I mean, even if Jhin'Air can win this game, they are really not looking like a playoff caliber team, Bubba Smithy. I think you can say that at the very least, because there have been some massive errors throughout this series.
And the team fighting in general, that's the one area where Jhin'Air just aren't a good team fighting team. That's not something they seem to be able to do.
No. And even the decision making. And Secret actually going to flash forward on a Chaser. They want to take him out, but he's going to just get out of the choke with the help of the Agony's Embrace. And a quick retreat here from Spenu. Meanwhile, Soul getting some good damage down onto the topside turret. May be able to take this objective soon.
He did opt into the Hex Drinker, so chipping away at the turret, chipping away at Trace. Level 13, so now 5 points in Hyper. Those auto attacks are now doing very respectable damage to Trace. He has a null magic mantle, but no much more magic resist outside of the move.
Yeah, still going to walk forward, though. Arcane Smash the wave, not ready to give up his tower quite yet. GBM still trying to power up right now. He should hit his Seraph's Embrace within the next 2 minutes or so. And that will be a very nice opportunity for him. Remember that his Rod of Ages will be fully stacked by about 24 and a half minutes.
Secret did have the Distortion Boots when he went for the Flash Tippers, but that's still another cooldown that Spenu has to play around. The only true engage at present point reliably is the Flash Tippers. And can Soul get the massive Gnar ult to really justify the pick?
Well, and that's what we're going to be finding out with the Gragas, a little bit of anti-synergy right there. But if he can follow up on Secret, he may be okay. We do still see that big CS lead for Chaser. He is considerably more wealthy than his jungle opposition. Seraph's Embrace now done.
Early Seraph's Embrace done. Suddenly super tanky between the shield passive he gets already. Trace doing a great job of buying time when it comes to this tower. It's definitely on a timer. It'll definitely be down the next 2 to 3 minutes, but Trey's doing everything he can to stop another bit of global gold coming through for Spinner.
Yeah, they still have the gold lead, Jenner. In spite of everything, they actually have that turret advantage with both side turrets down, but it looks like they're just going to choose to give this up. And Trace will home guard into the top side, now has a cowl, dragging up in a minute and a half. And they're going to want to take this first one, as Spenu already grabbed one of their own. And they're in a much better place to fight the dragon this time.
Chase has gone for selfish statistics. He has the Giant's Belt. They're not looking to build an Aegis. Now, it's only a single AP liner, depending on, well, of course, the support and jungle doing magic damage, but not feeling necessitated to have to pick up the Aegis. So if they can eliminate Sarsen first, that extra Giant's Belt should help to deal with the Sivir damage. Of course, Infinity Edge needs to be accounted for.
Well, I think the Randuin's Omen early is just more advantageous, because what you need is GBM just to be able to walk through a team fight, and any additional CC that you can get to help him do that and to set up a lot of Ryze AoE is going to be very helpful.
Dragon is going to spawn in 30 seconds. If they can pull it out for a minute, we're talking 10 stack blue buff Rod of Ages with the Seraph's Embrace. Remember, when Spinner was able to get a bit of momentum back into this game, that was with GBM not grouped with his team.
So, looks like the ward's already down for Jhin'er though, so Spinner going to have a hard time doing that. Chaser's just waiting there next to a speed shrine. They have the vision advantage to be sure. So Trace starting to work his way down.
Very nice flank ward. It's a very deep pink ward.
Well, Chaser has great positioning right now. If the rest of his team could follow up, are they going to pull the trigger? He is just hiding in a black spot. And here we go. Agony's Embrace not really going to hit anybody. Actually, Trace there with the TP on the outside. GBM, he's going to start doing work. But look at that. Sweet falls down. Nearly immediately, GBM is killed. And that may be it, actually, as we do see, oh, very low. Sassen still chasing Trace on the outside. The tree gets a double kill. Pilot there. Wow, that was incredibly close for Jhin'er as they botched their engage just a little bit. Can they come around and get this dragon? They're taking some decent damage, and Sassen wants to poke them out with that death ray.
Waiting to see if they'll finish this up. Pilot still close to full health. 1,000 health on the dragon. The teleport comes through. They're going to look for some kills at least.
Yeah, Soul comes back around. Trace is just going to give his life right now. He no longer has the flash. So a kill goes down. Pilot escapes down to the bottom.
Now we have a delayed teleport timer for Soul. You know, credit to him. He did harass out Pilot, but couldn't pick up any kills, and now feels like Trace will have first use of the teleport. It was nice flanking, honestly, from both Maokai and Evelynn, but the result was that both Leona and Ryze were at the wrong side of the fight.
Well, that Agony's Embrace really didn't do much either, and look at that. The Tibber is just hitting Sweet and GBM immediately.
They were on the other side of the fight, so Nuclear actually flashed on top of both members to get the early kills. It's only now that Pilot's coming into the fight, because he wasn't grouped with tank line as well. Jhin'er's positioning was all over the place, trying to create a situation where Ryze could just free hit one, two targets, but in the end, he just got collapsed upon, and they lost the fight.
Well, that's the danger, right, with flanking, is that if GBM got too close too fast alongside Sweet, you really have to time it well. Otherwise, a collapse onto the flank, like what Spenu does, deals a lot of damage. We look at a situation where Jhin'er had the right idea, but the execution was just a little bit off.
Teamfight execution has been eluding them all series. Honestly, most of the last 6 weeks in this whole season, if you want to be realistic about it, it's not been their strong point. And this is probably the best series Spenu has put out in terms of actually being competitive, even in this third game.
Yeah, and with that too, they snag a gold lead, wow, which is nice for them,
that's
actually.
It's probably the first time they've been in a third game with a gold lead, you know, more than maybe 5-6 minutes into the game.
Oh man, if Spenu can win this, it is an absolute nightmare for Jhin'er and a huge, huge help for Najin.
Honestly, with the way Najin's playing at the moment, they don't need too much help or too much invitation to be able to assault both the playoff positions and potentially higher than that.
Yeah, absolutely. So, especially Najin upsetting the Ku Tigers recently, too.
This Jenner team doesn't look like a team that's going to be upsetting anyone up the top of the standings.
No, I mean, if this game is this close against a team that has yet to win a best of three, there are real big problems for Jenner.
Let's not write them away. They do have Arise, who just hasn't been involved in team fights in an ideal sense, first being completely absent from the first 4v5 skirmish, which is on Jenner for engaging in a situation where Ryze had no way to get there, and then just being collapsed upon. So let's see if in more similar terrain, when they're fighting on a more even keel, whether GBM can actually take over these fights. Because this is 5-patch 5.13. Ryze is still pretty damn strong.
He is undoubtedly pretty damn strong. And now,
great synergy with the magic damage as well, with the magic damage shred that he puts out. So if you group Spenu, there could be deletion coming through from Jhin.
Yeah, and they don't need the Maokai to flank here. I think that's one of the big things that they're not considering, is that Maokai just needs to stand in front of Ryze. Sure, Eve can flank, that's okay. But you don't have to have that. You just need the Maokai to peel. But they've been having trouble peeling off of their primary carries. That's how they lost the last game.
Hogmore left to the Wolves. They cannot let the same thing happen with Ryze. It's happened once already.
It's harder to leave Ryze to the Wolves, though. Much more durable, especially in the late game.
Not quite the durable tank that he once was, though. You still seem to see more AP being built. Void Staff earlier. You don't build into the Frozen Heart or Magic Resist as simply as you used to, mainly because, you know, Riot tried to remove the incentive to build cooldown reduction now that you get 30% CDR free from your ultimate. So the itemization's a bit different, and the result is a squishier but definitely higher damage, right?
Yes. Well, Chaser and the rest of Jhin'er will get supremacy over the Scuttle Crab.
I like the Banshee Veil purchase from Soul a lot. It's just one less CC he has to worry about when he goes to look for that position for the Mega Gnar transformation. So, Home Guard Banshee Veil. We still haven't seen the Epic Gnar, but threat is always there.
He's starting. Where's his money coming from, actually? Trace should have quite a bit of extra cash to spend, just given what we're looking at in terms of the items right now. Because if that Randuin's is nearly completed on the Soul, and Trace has not so much. Well, there's the Shroud. He's getting up there, but interesting.
Main statistics and teamfight statistics for Soul when, you know, not long ago, he was sitting on just a cowl in lane against Malka.
Yeah, and falling behind in terms of CS, now he has taken the lead in that category. Starting to farm up, and, you know, Jhin'er, they really want to take out this mid turret. It would help them out a lot when it comes to engaging these teamfights. It will open up Evelynn for more flanking routes.
Both Maokai and Evelynn love it when the turrets go down because you get those flank wards, you get that extra space to come through. Of course, you cannot use the coves next to this outer turret for an Evelynn flank because you will be sinned by the outer turret's vision.
Jhin'er happy just to wait for the next dragon fight. Maybe they want to stack that one up. They got the last one. It came at a pretty high price. Are they going to try a different form of engage in this one once more? They have more wards around the river.
Are they overthinking it? Chase is always, you know, standing deceptively smart positions, but then Maokai also goes for the flank, and surely the way to deal with a double flank is just collapse on the three members left over,
yeah.
And he's the best champion to do that with.
I think Trace has realized that he's actually not going for a flank this time. He is standing in front of his carries, which is the proper positioning, I feel, given the current circumstances. And so now, actually, Spenu, leaves the river, so they have a really good opportunity just to go for the dragon here once they get Pilot and GBM wrapped back around.
Locket is completed. We mentioned that Chaser wasn't going to be building into that. Had the Giant's Belt a long time ago, only added a Warden's Mail. Has the goal to finish the Randuin's, but just not had a buy timing. So Chaser hasn't changed in power for quite a long time.
Okay, well, still no good vision in the river. Jhin'er just monopolizing that with a pink ward in the pixel brush. So they're gonna start actually doing this dragon right now, but they're a little bit spread out. Looks like they're gonna get it for free. And no contest here from Spenu. That could have been a very good opportunity for them to all in with a Sivir ultimate, but they didn't have the vision to do it, so Jhin'er get away with it.
Smart of them to never funnel into a 4-5 man solar flare or into any other kind of threatening engage. So second dragon's certainly not a big thing in terms of both the timer, because, man, fifth dragon's a long, long way away, and second dragon's immediate stats, not really relevant.
Okay, well, still more pink wards going in. Spenu trying to set up a pick right now. Oh, Trace, TP goes in. Are they going to get up? GBM is caught out, actually has to flash immediately. Now, can they turn this? Trace still in the front line, taking a lot. Soul's going to be there. Pilot putting in some rockets from the back line, and Trace gets out with the flash. So Spenu commits, but they don't get a kill. Really close.
Super, super close. Sweet wasn't there. He didn't get to use any of his abilities. Flash away from Trace keeps him alive. Has the teleport if they want to ring edge, and a massive minion wave in top needs to be answered right now. And Jin is running straight to Baron.
Yeah, they want to do the Baron. They didn't actually lose that much HP, and Trace is there. He's got the home guard and the TP. They're waiting to bait this. They want to go in if they can. So this is a fight in the making. There's the teleport. Gravity field dropped immediately, but Trace gets slowed down, just going to turn back. So Jin Air doesn't commit to much of anything.
Feels like they could have gone for that. There wasn't position. There was no teleport on Soul. In terms of levels, Chaser and Catcher were at the same exact level. So Spenu gets a chance to go clean up that massive minion wave and don't get punished with Baron. And look at that. 2,600 gold on Sivir. They were actually in a gold deficit if there was a fight.
Yeah, that is pretty huge. And even though they dropped that gravity field, maybe there was still enough to follow up from Jin Air, or at least just stick onto the Baron. That was not a good teleport. Didn't have much of an effect whatsoever and was very easily countered by Sasin.
Nuclear had 1,350 gold, so no BF sword gold, so buys a little bit of everything. Needs the QSS clearly to deal with the Malco, even the Rise route. There's a lot of CC, not even counting Leona, so at least has a bit of magic resist. Spenu's so close to getting a massive pick and really being able to force things, but just too tanky is Trace.
And they caught out GBM, but he had his summoners up, so was able to clear out pretty darn quick.
Hasn't been able to fit distortion boots into his build. That would obviously really help him be realistically up for every neutral fight, given the, what, 4-minute cooldown that would result from the cooldown reduction mechanic of the distortion boots, but has to itemize into the distortion. He's got his damage core down, though, so if he finally gets a fight where he's able to reuse his spells, things will be very different for Jin Air.
Spenu's not making it easy for him, though. They have been quite skillful when it comes to locking down the Rise.
It's been by far their primary focus, and you know, killing Kog'Maw was their focus last game. They managed to finally pull that off in the last fight. We're getting closer and closer to that point where death timers are really going to start to tick up, and relying on Jin Air or betting on Jin Air to win a late game teamfight is just not good odds. It's not good gambling.
No, it's not. Even when they have something as potent as a Rise on this patch, oh, they are looking to push forward again. I mean, I think Jin Air is just happy to play the dragon game right now and continue to win these warding battles, which has been a trend.
The dragon game, though, just doesn't feel relevant, Monte Cristo.
No, it doesn't.
It's not going to be a fifth dragon. The game will be decided by the time a fifth dragon rolls around. You need to have monopolized and started that objective far, far earlier. And you keep opting into fighting around a narrow crevice. Nah, Annie will make you pay one of these times, specifically with the Sivir speed buff.
Yeah, there's so many ways to get onto the opposition. Secret's flash is just about to come up, too, so maybe they'll make another attempt. You can see Chaser, he keeps trying to be cute, but there's a lot of pink ward flanks from Spenu. They are well prepared for this. Sweet will have a chance to maybe clear out one of them, and he will get it in the end, so that's slightly helpful, but it's just a very delicate dance here in the mid side. Chaser knows there's a pink ward there, so he can't go in, really.
How many games have there been where Jin Air gets a small advantage towards the late game, has a quite large advantage, but has no idea on how to finish the game? They're not good at side wave minion control. They're not smart on pulling off turret dives, and they just make a lot of mistakes, even when they have things like Twisted Fate with teleport or a supremely strong late game champion like Ryze.
Okay. Well, they allowed Spenu to get into the river. They're going to get the Scuttle Crab and clear out some vision. Chaser will be seen. And now they finally get that pink ward right there. So it's just this circular movement around the Baron right now for both teams. They don't actually kill the Pink Ward.
Get some time to take out a big minion wave in top. There's a big minion wave in bottom that's pushing out that Ryze looks like he's going to be able to go clean out. They choose to start a fight with the Sivir ultimate. It'll draw the ghost out from Ryze. He'll still probably be late, but it seems like everyone's happy to trade farm. And I want to hand that over to Jhin'er because we're talking about handing over farm to Ryze versus this Gnar in the top lane, but I've learned better than to bet on Jhin'er in the late game.
Yeah, I think we all learned that in the last game. No recall yet from this Ryze. He's got quite a bit of money on him at the moment, but for that matter, so do Soul and Nuclear.
Okay. GBM's about 50 gold short of a Banshee Veil. Maybe that will be the answer, because finally Annie won't be able to ruin his day at the start of a fight. Almost every fight when Ryze has been grouped, Annie's just been looking to flash tip his GBM to ensure that he's either dead or chunked out to the point where it's not realistic for him to stand in 600 range and chain out those rune prisons like Ryze is wont to do.
So they're going to get the position onto the dragon one more time. Chaser still looking for some creative pathing on this Evelynn, but Secret has his number this game. He's been catching him out when necessary. It looks like Jhin'er going to opt into a bit of a 50-50. Secret is intelligently anticipating the flank right now. Look at that, finds it. And that means that the jungler not going to be a part of this for a little bit. Secret playing well in this situation. Catch wants to go in on this, and they know that Evelynn's not there, so that Jhin'er can't really get this dragon. Chaser was seen and now has to back off.
His teamfight position from Spenu is better than anything Jhin'er's put together so far this series. Been very smart to have Sivir and Victor grouped towards the bottom side, knowing that the only way Evelynn could get in is from the top side. Looks like they've given up completely, and Sarsen's just chasing Chaser.
Well, what do you do right there? You can't actually finish the dragon because your smite isn't there. So that's easily taken by Spenu in the end.
For Jhin'er to get so comprehensively outthought, I guess it must have been the minion wave they had to account for, but yeah, there's nothing they could do. And look, it's a second dragon again, not really relevant statistics, but symptomatic of what has been a consistent trend for this team.
Well, they just seem to be getting too fancy. We saw this with the teleport TF, where they ended up running circles around themselves, and yeah, they want this flank, but Secret's denying it pretty well. And if they don't have the Eve there, they can't contest the dragon. They can't actually do it in a 50-50. So they needed to make a choice whether to back off the dragon and try and engage or have Chaser with your team and take the dragon. You can't make both decisions at the same time.
Jhin'er's decision-making, a bit of a spinner. We see the CLG spinner back in there. It feels like the Jhin'er spinner involves brush camps and double flanks and teleport shenanigans, but
double globals on the same champion.
Yeah, that's what they like to do. GBM was looking for the brush flank. He's looking for a flank, but now he's caught with his pants down. There's lots of members coming. Doesn't
he missed
matter how
two
much
Qs.
He has.
And there you go, knocked around. GBM is just going to get blown up as there was another instance of Jhin'er being isolated. Trace tries to be the hero, but I don't think he's going to live. Chaos Storm still ticking away. Trace goes down. It looks like Spenu could just Baron off of that. I have no idea what GBM was doing there.
His first instinct to stand in the brush next to the Krugs was fine, but then he went for some sort of solo gorilla mission, Metal Gear Solid style, and died for free.
Well, not only that, but his Ryze mechanics, he missed two Qs at the start of that.
Super, super strange play. Remember, this whole game, multiple members from Jhin'er have been looking for the flank. They're very well aware that either Evelynn or Maokai is on the flank. Why is it going to be any different if Ryze is there? Because they have accounted for their flanks masterfully this game.
Yeah, and that you have to really give props to Spenu for actually anticipating a lot of what was going on, not only in terms of pink wards, but I don't know why GBM is here right now.
He missed two Qs, as you mentioned. Didn't even notice that, but more than slightly embarrassing.
He missed another one there, too. He missed three in that entire sequence of spells. And after that, it's just piling through. It's so easy with the Sivir to keep on moving through these fights.
41 minutes in, regardless of the results, Spenu Sonic Boom is in prime position to take their first win of the season and deny the playoff hopes. in all but name for Jhin'Air.
It would take really, really a big loss from Najin not to be able to bounce back from this. Because remember, Najin's already a win ahead. Now, Jhin'Air has one more series to play, so it could end up in some sort of tiebreaker scenario. But it's not looking good as Spenu continues to put on the siege right now. And they will just zone him off with the gravity field and take down another tier two. So they're starting to move up in terms of gold lead. Now, it's not done for Jhin'Air. It is still a late game prize.
That's the Banshee Veil now, just one item slot short of being six items, but that's the case for most of the Spenu members as well. When you look at the late game scaling, it is with Jhin'Air primarily because of the Ryze, but we keep talking about that scenario where Ryze gets consistent damage off, and just like accounting for their flanks, Spenu have never let that happen.
No, but you actually have to hit your spells now in order for Ryze to do that consistent damage, Papa Smithy. That's the key that you may not be understanding.
Some of those spells are targeted. In fact, two of the three.
Yeah, that's true. Well, they were kind of cues flying all over the place in that last little engagement. I don't think it would have changed anything, but it was sloppy.
It probably would have been a 2-for-1, maybe. They would have picked up a kill somewhere, so would it have still been the Baron? I guess that's the question we don't know the answer to. Spenu just going to keep pushing around the side waves. Their side wave control has been pretty good this game. Not quite Samsung level, not quite Anarchy level, but fine. And they're pushing with Baron, so realistically, it should be another uncontested objective for Spenu.
Well, you know what's funny, Papa Smithy, is after KT lost to SKT, we said, well, there's probably no more hope for defeating SKT. And then CJ came out of the blue and pulled it off. And after Spenu lost to IM and they lost to Anarchy, we said, there's no hope now.
Lost to Samsung twice as well.
There's no more hope for them right here to win a series this season, but oh man, are they close now. And it would be a huge upset.
But this is not just about Jhin'Air playing badly. Credit to Spenu. They have understood that Jhin'Air's only way to win is get that Evelynn into the backline, but Evelynn been on the outside of every single fight.
Yep, and yet another pink ward. The circuitous routes that Chaser has had to take to try and find these engages are not doing them any favors. So they're going to back off. Another dragon should be going Spenu's way. The Baron buff has fallen off at this point, but they got the three tier twos with it. They're going to get their third dragon stack almost certainly after a recall. And it's all up to a heroic defense right now from Jhin'Air at a 7K deficit.
Exciting to see Spenu in this position. Not something I expected at the start of today. We were kind of shaking our heads after game two, thinking, all right, why did Jhin'Air have to subject us to a third game? Whenever we've seen these Spenu series go to three games, third game's been kind of just rolling over and dying, but this is 45 minutes of better than solid, of good, strong, strategic League of Legends from Spenu Sonic Boom.
Yeah, they haven't really made too many errors here, and
fans have a lot to be optimistic about.
They certainly do. Well, here we go. Dragon will be taken down by Spenu. There's no one there from Jhin'Air to even remotely contest this. So free Dragon, number three.
Soul completely not pressured, able to walk to top. Man, he's super tanky now with the Guardian Angel. Maybe even fit in some damage. Could turn that Giant's Belt into a Frozen Mallet. Maybe that's the right call. Could just go for tankiness, I guess.
Warmogs.
Yep, he's kind of free to build whatever he wants. We'll always have irrelevant damage, specifically with the Hyper. Yeah, just waiting to see if Spenu will make this colossal mistake, because for right now, they're very much controlling this game.
Yes, they are. They're going to use some lenses on the brush. They're not going to there we go. Find the ward eventually, thanks to the Oracle's lens from Catch. There's a bunch of pings going down from Jhin'Air. I'm not really sure what they're trying to indicate right now about the river. It looks like they may want to try and punish a possible bot lane siege.
Maybe they were pinging out a route for Chase to get around the back of
Warp.
That's possible for the Evelynn, but minute 30 to Baron.
Those are excellent pink ward placements, by the way, for dealing with an Evelynn flank if you're sieging behind the red buff, and then right at that brush, there's no really opportunity unless you go all the way around in the river. Well, you know, I'm going to feel bad no matter who wins this game, Papa Smithy, because I'll feel bad for Spenu that they came so close to actually getting their first win, and I'll feel bad for Jhin'Air for maybe not being able to go to the playoffs or go to Worlds. It's not a happy situation in this game. If it had been a quick match against Spenu, you kind of shrug your shoulders and say, well, this is what Spenu is sort of used to, but now that they've actually given it their all, it would be very disappointing for them to have come so close to taking out a top six team and then failing.
It's kind of crazy to think that, you know, when Jenner played SKT for the first time this season, they were one of those teams that was really had the potential to unsettle SKT. Now, the meta's shifted a bit since then, and Jenner's fortunes have certainly dipped substantially since then, but I didn't think it would come to this.
No, I don't think anybody did. I don't think this could have been predicted whatsoever.
Victor swaps around his items, now has a death cap, so that's six item Victor. Even has the perfect tech score, so maybe he's short of a sorcery elixir, but otherwise, super, super powered up.
Yes, he is, and GBM probably going to be finishing off his build with a Guardian Angel.
Secret has it all.
Oh, Sweet gets knocked out. He's going to get picked. There he goes. He dies, and that might be the end of the game. Now we see Soul coming in. Only gets Trace with his ultimate. Soul actually eating a lot of damage from the Ryze. Catching the front line right now, and Nuclear trying to do some work. There's the Chaos Storm going down. They want to get Chaser. Trace going to dodge that death ray. GBM almost untouched, but he's taking a lot of damage from Nuclear. Here we go, and they're going to get GBM. And that is two for none in the end. And this is almost certainly going to be the final push as Soul is going to TP on top of Tibbers. Can they get the necessary damage down? Pilot is still alive.
Spenu fans
Holy are
screaming cow. Their lungs out, and they're going to try and finish desperately. There's still three threats up.
There still are. Sasin is very low. Chaser wants to get in, but he's going to get stopped, and Pilot dies. Nuclear and Soul on top of him. Trace, he's trying to get the low members, and there is GBM on your screen right now. And this is going to be the first win for Spenu. Sonic Boom on the season against all odds when there is nothing for them on the line. They will take out Jin Air and maybe, just maybe, spoil Jin Air's chance at playoffs and the World Championship.
Jin Air had everything on the line, Monte Cristo. They wanted to pick up the 2-0 win to keep it up there with Najin, to keep it up there with CJ Enters. They dropped one game, and that already put a single arrow through their hearts. But man, they've got nothing left now.
Wow, that is such an impressive upset. You can see Sasin on your screen right now.
Sasin face means something very different now, Monte Cristo. That man is happy.
That man is happy. GBM looking pretty devastated, as well you can imagine. And he thought it was going to be a cakewalk, especially coming into that second game, but their hopes are dashed.
And the crazy thing is, he picked out the right tie. Shame it was for their own fortunes.
Well, you know, Jin Air actually had played one fewer best of three, so they're not entirely out yet. They still have two more chances of redemption, but it is going to be much, much harder for them now. And Spenu, the team who had nothing to play for, who had not won a single best of three this season,